Just two quick things before we begin. If it sounds like I talk a little bit funny, it's because I have a wire dental appliance in my mouth. And also just a little disclaimer, I'm not a dentist. And there's some people, if you have really difficult imbalances, that you're going to need more additional help than diet, maybe 1 to 3% of the general population. So just to keep that in mind. More tailored, individualized help. So I'm here to bring you good news that you can heal your tooth cavities. And I want to invite in the spirit of our ancestors, the people who knew how to eat healthy and live in harmony. I started researching cavities about 5.5 years ago because my daughter had a little white spot on her tooth. And very quickly, that white spot became a brown spot. There was more, and that original tooth crumbled apart. And as parents, of course, we were really distressed and didn't know what to do. And when we contacted the dentist about what can we do for this kind of condition, I just was not happy with the treatments they had. They didn't sound like they were going to solve the problem, and I didn't want to subject my daughter do that. So I went out to find a real solution. And eventually I came across the work of Weston Price. I took his information, we did trial and error, I read a bunch of other stuff, and eventually we found a program that worked. Once we had something that I felt was stopping the cavities, I felt like, well, how do I let other people know? And so I started to write about it. And my first article was published in the Townsend Letter of Doctors and Patients, I think in 2007. And I was actually inspired by Weston Price to write the book because I saw in this old dental journal, he had an outline of a book called The Etiology and Control of Dental Caries, and he never made it. I think it became Nutrition and Physical Degeneration. I called Price Ponderous. Do you have this book? No. Any books on cavities? No. Okay. So I wrote a book, and then kept revising it, kept getting feedback, kept doing more and more research, and this is the fourth time I've rewritten it right now, and I have excellent information and been able to help a lot of people reduce their need for dental treatments or completely avoid dental treatments. So let's look at some excellent examples. This is from Leroy. I was ready to have the tooth pulled, and a dentist told me I needed a root canal. I had no money for either procedure. I was in pain, and my cheek had already begun to swell. But after over a month of following your dietary protocols, it was hard for me to feel which tooth was bothering me. Thanks a million, Ramiel. Unbelievable. Here's another testimonial from Mike and Ashland. Might be a little hard for you guys to see in the back, but I'll read it. The practical advice in this book really seems to be reversing my tooth decay. Hallelujah, brother. The dentist wanted me to have two major root canals and two other teeth filled. When I asked him if there was anything I could do with nutrition or supplements to get my teeth to heal, he said no. That dental visit was 3 months ago, and my teeth have stopped aching altogether. I bought the book for $28. What a bargain. The dental work was going to cost well over $4,000. No wonder dentists don't seem open to this stuff working. Think I'm excited? You will be too when you use this information and take tooth health into your own hands. Very satisfied, Mike. A woman received a large bill from her dentist, and she called him to complain. Said, I'm shocked at this bill, she said. And the dentist said, I'm shocked with this bill. It's three times what you normally charge. And then I said, I know, but you screamed so loud you scared away two patients. So if you have a cavity, is this even worth our time to talk about healing cavities? I mean, if you have a tooth problem, can't you just go to the dentist and have them take care of it? Isn't the problem solved? Let's take a look. There you see a small cavity where the red arrow is pointing. In order to get rid of the infestation of bacteria, the dentist is going to drill out that cavity. And just for perspective, if you could remineralize that cavity, that tooth could stay just like that. That's an example of that's not the exact same tooth, but that's an example of the size of a hole that could be drilled for a cavity that big. Once a hole that big is drilled, even when you remineralize the tooth, that hole is not really going to fill in. It may happen in rare occasions, but tooth is going to get hard, but you're still going to have that hole. So the dentist drills a big hole in your tooth to prevent the bacteria from making a hole in your tooth. This big hole drilling thing paradigm is over 100 years old. It was designed by dentist G.V. Black in order to place mercury filling. You had to drill a big hole to get that filling to stay and not need a treatment really quickly. After drilling comes filling. So that's a composite filling. One of the most popular composites reacts negatively to 90% of people's immune systems. And on average, 50% of the people's immune system react negatively to composite filling. You see a little slice there of the mercury fillings, which you're going to hear more about, and you guys know are toxic. So the dentist removes your tooth and replaces it with a synthetic material, which is many times poisonous. Now, there are a few exceptional dentists who no longer place toxic materials, but I'm talking about conventional dentistry here that's happened in mass, and most of us have this dentistry in our mouths. Drilling and filling, and then comes billing. Those are $100 bills, and root canal can set you back quite a bit. Does drilling, filling, and billing cure cavities? The average filling material lasts 5 to 12 years. In the drilling process, healthy tooth structure is drilled away that will never be, can never be restored. The natural tooth is never going to be back. So what you see here is more of a business model than a healthcare system, preventative system. Conventional dentistry is obsessed at getting rid of the bacteria. You have to brush to remove your bacteria. You have to floss to remove the bacteria. You have to drink mouthwash. A lot of them are toxic to kill all the bacteria that are supposed to be causing your tooth problems. When getting rid of the bacteria fails through those methods, you do the drilling and filling, and the dentist removes the bacteria. Sometime later, that fails too, and your tooth gets an infection, and the dentist is going to clean out that infection with a root canal, where he removes the whole inside of your tooth to get rid of those bacteria. And finally, when the root canal fails, the infection has just progressed too far, and your tooth is removed, and you have implants or nothing. Streptococcus mutans is supposed to be the bacteria that cause cavities. Are those spheres the cause of the problem? Maybe if we look at it at a higher magnification, we can see really what's going on. As you all already know, the war against bacteria doesn't work. That's why you guys are here. Here's what the American Dental Association says about bacteria. When you eat, and this is what conventional dentistry believes, so that's why I'm using that quote. When you eat or drink foods containing sugars or starches, the bacteria in plaque produce acids that attack tooth enamel. After many such attacks, a cavity forms. This theory was invented and brought forward in 1882 by W.D. Miller. He put teeth in test tubes and saw what happened. And he said he discovered one way, he didn't say he discovered all the ways in which cavities form. And that way is from acid eating away tooth enamel. But he also said something else very important. The perfect tooth would resist indefinitely acid. So when the American Dental Association and dentists say bacteria is putting acid on your tooth and causing cavities, they don't tell you that the originator of the theory also said, and healthy teeth are immune to acid. So by blaming bacteria and blaming what bacteria eat, we've been disempowered. If we started looking at the strength of the tooth, then we start asking ourselves, how do we get strong teeth? Well, it's going to be what we eat. So I want to tell you about modern research on tooth cavities. This is based on the life work of dentists Ralph Simon and John Lenora. What you're seeing here is the microscopic tubes in your tooth. This is the tubes near the center. There's about 3 miles of the microscopic tubes in each tooth. The tubes contain a nutrient-rich fluid called dentinal lymph. It's similar to cerebral spinal fluid in our body. When tooth decay is active, the fluid goes in from the outside of your mouth into the center of the tooth, and it's regulated by little cells that create kind of a pressure pump system. When tooth decay is remineralizing, the fluid travels outward. In their book, they say, you know, this has nothing to do with bacteria, tooth decay. But the other dentists don't seem to get it yet. That's kind of what they said. Let's look at what controls the mechanism of tooth remineralization. In your brain, the hypothalamus is going to be probably analyzing your blood chemistry, the minerals, health, toxins, what's in your blood. It sends a message to the parotid gland in your jaw, a hormonal message. The parotid gland sends another message to the tooth and says, mineralize or demineralize, based on the flow of the fluids. Some of us don't have strong glands, parotid glands, or maybe a thyroid, and that's why some people have cavities and others don't. Someone might have a strong parotid gland and a weak other glands, and so when they lose minerals in their body, maybe they lose minerals in their legs or their hips, and they don't lose it in their teeth. That's why there's people who are moderately immune to cavities who don't eat well occasionally because of the gland, strong gland. So, if toothbrushing, toothpaste, dental treatments, fluoride, mouthwashes really work, then why do the majority of us still have cavities? Do we all not go to the dentist and not brush? Or is there something wrong with what we've been told? You know, all know about Weston Price. And he traveled all over the world to study what happens when native peoples eat modern foods. His travels are documented in his book, Nutrition and Physical Degeneration. I'm just going to go over them really briefly. If you want the extensive story, get that book. In my Cure Tooth Decay, I have a brief summary of his field studies with some of the photographs that I've licensed. But if you want to go more deeply, look at this book, and also Sally has a great presentation. Maybe tooth decay is genetic. Weston Price gave us the example of two brothers. The brother on the left, severe cavities. The brother on the right, no cavities. What's the difference? The younger boy had extensive tooth decay. Many teeth were missing, including two in the front. He insisted on having white bread, jam, highly sweetened coffee, and also sweet chocolates. His father told me with deep concern how difficult it was for this boy to get up in the morning and go to work. The older boy with excellent teeth was still enjoying his primitive food of oatmeal, oat cake, seafoods, and some limited dairy products. Pretty much everything in the presentation is in my book, just in case you don't have to scramble to get all the details down. So what Weston Price did is he went to a laboratory and took thousands of food samples all over the world, and this is his results. The indigenous diet has 10 times or more fat-soluble vitamins and 2 to 4 times minerals. He took that information and then applied it. He asked the fellow dentist to give him the worst cases of cavities. He increased their fat-soluble vitamin intake, increased their mineral intake, and had a 250 times reduction in the rate of cavities. So he proved what was wrong with our diet and why people had cavities because of a nutrient deficiency. And he was able to correct cavities by resolving the nutrient deficiency. You can see here the biggest imbalance is the fat-soluble vitamins. So if we want to do the best we can to cure cavities with the least work, we're going to concentrate out on the worst deficiency we have in the modern world, the fat-soluble vitamins. So how do you remineralize teeth? Weston Price noticed that not all the groups he studied were completely immune to cavities. Some had a little bit of cavities, much less than in the modern world. And he found that groups that were 100% immune, like no one had cavities, ate from two of the three special food groups, special fat-soluble vitamin food groups, grass-fed dairy, particularly when the cows eat rapidly growing green grass, organs from the land animals, and organs and other meat from the sea. So if we want to be the most immune to cavities or heal a severe problem, we want to incorporate two of these three special food categories. There's also a fourth category of special fat-soluble vitamins. Insects. And you know, every year I look at the menu and there's no grasshopper tacos. free-range grubs. Maybe next year. And the vitamins that are in some insects, the vitamin is vitamin D. Edward Mallinby, we're going to look at him a little more later. He was the discoverer of vitamin D. He was a very well-respected researcher and from England, and a professor and a doctor. And he and his wife did extensive studies on tooth decay and rickets. He also even spoke in front of the American Medical Association. And this is what he told them is, we can pretty much cure any cavity. That's a paraphrasing to the American Medical Association. But here's also what he said. By far the most important factor producing well-calcified bones and teeth is vitamin D. So if we want to heal our teeth and make them really hard and strong, vitamin D is probably the most important. And what's special about vitamin D? Vitamin D helps our body deposit the calcium and phosphorus into the bones. If you guys want more detailed, scientific, nitty-gritty stuff on vitamin D and the fat-soluble vitamins, there's many articles by Chris Masterjohn and talks. He's the expert on that category for all those scientific, more details. I like to focus on, you know, like, what do we need to eat? The most concentrated sources is seafoods, particularly cod liver or other fish livers. Oily fish is up there, very dense source of vitamin D. Duck eggs. Animal blood. So there's some cultures maybe that didn't have seafood access and they didn't use dairy. They would have gotten their vitamin D from animal blood. And that's, you know, we just waste all of our animal blood. In other cultures, they make it into cakes and curds and save it. Beef fat. One little note I got from the, I think an article from Mae Mallinby, his wife, is when they're doing healing cavity experiments, lard wasn't that helpful. Even though lard has vitamin D, for whatever reason, they didn't find that really worked well to remineralize teeth. But suet, beef fat, from the fatty deposit, that was much more effective. I don't know how much vitamin D is in suet. I could not find any nutritional data. A very important note. Land animal livers like beef liver, chicken liver, pork, I don't know if it's all land animal livers, but the ones that we commonly eat do not have very much vitamin D. So you might say, oh, I'm getting eating my liver. I don't need cod liver oil. I'm getting my vitamin D. Not really the case. The next fat-soluble vitamin we're going to look at is fat-soluble vitamin A. Fat-soluble vitamin A promotes vision, is important for vision, bone growth, reproduction, cell division, prenatal development, and it increases growth factors, so it helps our body grow and regenerate. What vitamin A does is it lowers our blood serum calcium. So it helps our body use up calcium in our blood. There's a dentist, Melvin Page, who took the work of Weston Price a little further, and he analyzed blood chemistry. And he found that healing teeth has everything to do with the calcium and phosphorus ratio in your blood. You want to balance that. When the calcium and phosphorus ratio is out of balance, you have tooth decay or gum disease. In order to balance the calcium and phosphorus ratio, the fat-soluble vitamins are the most effective way because they help your body make use of the calcium and phosphorus in your diet. So where do you get the vitamin A? Liver. Far and above the most concentrated source. Oh, and another note is, you notice there's no vegetables on any of these lists yet? And vitamin A, you can't get the same kind of vitamin A from vegetables. You get the carotene vitamin A, which your body has to convert to true vitamin A. The conversion is very inefficient and probably needs the fat-soluble vitamin A to happen. So I think vegetables are good, but you can't count on that to heal your teeth. The other dense source is animal iron. And that's part of probably why the fish head or whatever is the delicacy, the cow head, the lamb head. The non-flesh sources of vitamin A have a lot less vitamin A, but you can still get a good amount of vitamin A. Goat cheese, eggs, butter. Most butter doesn't have very much vitamin D either, has a little bit. So I've just found, this is one of the things through experience, liver, eating the actual liver is very effective in healing cavities. It might be the form of phosphorus, it might be the B vitamins, it might be the trace minerals, it could be something we don't know about. So in the balanced program that for serious people who want to maintain their health, who want to have organ meats twice a week, and liver would be a good one. The more variety, the better. Just to give you an example of how concentrated the vitamin A is in cod liver oil, I have this picture. 5.5 quarts of milk equals 1 teaspoon of cod liver oil, vitamin A, of good milk. 1 pound of good butter, or 9 eggs to get the same vitamin A you get in 1 teaspoon of cod liver oil. Because cod liver oil contains the fat-soluble vitamins A and D that our body needs to produce strong teeth and bones, it is very effective in preventing cavities. Weston Price talked about a schoolgirl study. There were 66 schoolgirls, and they were divided in half. The girls with the best teeth were the control, and the worst teeth were the experimental group. The girls with the worst teeth were given 2 teaspoons of cod liver oil per day. After 6 months, the girls with the worst teeth had 40% less cavities than the girls that originally had the better teeth. If you take cod liver oil every day, you're very likely to reduce your rate of cavities by at least 40%. How much should you take? I'm basing my dosage on what Weston Price used. 1 to 3 teaspoons per day. That's just a very general estimate. The Weston Price Foundation has high standards for how much vitamin D you have. So you probably, if you want to follow that, you probably need to be more towards the 3 teaspoons to get all that vitamin D. Anywhere between 1 to 3 teaspoons is good. If you have bad cavities, you want to take more. If you're maintaining, maybe you don't need as much. It's kind of something you gotta go with on how it feels. Maybe sometime one day you want to have a lot of cod liver oil, and maybe you avoid it for a couple days or a week. Can you get? Do commercial cod liver oils have fat-soluble vitamin D? The answer is not anymore. The heating, processing, refining of any store-bought cod liver oil completely destroys the vitamin D. If it says vitamin D on the label, it's not from the cod liver. At best, it's maybe from sheep's wool, and at worst, it's totally synthetic. And here, we know that we want to try to get the natural vitamins from the food. So Dave at Green Pastures has done all of us a big favor Because he made us like olive oil that retains most or all of the fat-soluble vitamins so that people who need them can still get them from their natural form. When you go to the dentist, the expectation is they're going to teach you how to prevent your cavities. If they wanted to do that, they'd have cod liver oil in their office, fermented kind. And they would, and everyone would have at least 40% less cavities, or almost everyone. So we talked about fat-soluble vitamins A and D. Weston Price thought there was something missing from our modern diet, and he called that activator X. Said there must be some food substance that's not adequately provided in modern tradition. Here at the Weston Price Foundation, we people call it K2. I like maintaining the whole concept idea, so I call it activator X. It's just terminology. The agreement is where it comes from. It comes from grass-fed butter, or grass-fed dairy fat, but it's not the dairy fat all year round. It's only the dairy fat when the cows have rapidly growing grass, and the butter becomes a deep yellow color. That butter is very good at helping teeth remineralize. Weston Price used that butter and gave it to lab rats, I believe, and it cured rickets. It cured rickets because it altered the blood calcium and phosphorus. We want to balance the blood calcium and phosphorus to stop cavities. The Activator X-rich butter does it. So butter year-round does not have Activator X, just at certain times, or much less Activator X, just at certain times of year has that really concentrated density of Activator X that we want to really make our teeth rock solid. So there's great farms here. If you want to get the Activator X from the food, the easiest way is with the grass-fed butter, but you want that spring or that butter after the rapid growth. Conveniently, the cows make more milk at that time. And that butter tastes better than the regular butter, a tablespoon or more per day. Now, what you can do is, there's two ways. You can preserve the butter by freezing it. That preserves the Activator X. You buy a lot during the springtime when there's extra. Or you can use green pasture supplements. Or you can do both. The green pasture supplements does a really good job of concentrating the good Activator X. How you want to do it is your choice. Weston Price found when he combined the cod liver oil with the Activator X, it had a synergistic effect. We know cod liver oil reduces cavities by 40%. When you have that with an Activator X-rich butter fat, you're going to be doing a whole lot better. So my basic recommendation for people who want the easy recommendation is to take your Green Pastures Royal Blend, which mixes the butter and cod liver oil together. And you want to take approximately half a teaspoon, 2 or 3 times per day. Now, an advanced guideline. People have bad cavities, or they don't like cod liver oil, but they want something extra, and that's the skate liver oil. The skate is just has some magical regenerative properties, and the native peoples really valued the shark livers. And those are hard to get, and sharks are very abused. But the skate, which is like a stingray, has very similar properties to the shark liver. So when you combine the royal blend with skate liver oil, you get an extra boost on your fat-soluble vitamins. This is what we should be doing with our vegetable fats, powering our vehicles. So we know that the vegetable oils are toxic, like the soy and the canola oil, corn oil, safflower oil. But what happened was when we started using those vegetable oils, we stopped using butter and lard and suet. So we stopped getting the fat-soluble vitamin. And that's why we didn't build or maintain healthy teeth and bones, because we ate vegetable fats instead of animal fats. So we looked at how to get the fat-soluble vitamin. Now let's look at some of how we can get minerals, and particularly the most important minerals, calcium and phosphorus. There's a town in Texas made famous by dentist George Heard, called it the town without a toothache, and had the lowest rate of cavities in the United States. What were they doing? Anyone want to know? After a newcomer has lived, this is George Heard's, you're right, newcomer has lived in Hereford a few years, provided he has drunk lots of whole raw milk, he develops resistance to tooth decay. Even the tooth cavities which he brings with him, when he comes to Hereford, will be glazed over if he has drunk raw milk. A surprisingly large number of patients without cavities liked either buttermilk, clabber, or both. The significant fact is that the milk those patients drank came from the native cows that had grazed on native grass in Deaf Smith County pastures. In winter, as a rule, the cows had grazed on green wheat. My fellow dentists heard me out of respectful attention. One dentist, Dr. Young, said, "If all our patients adhered to Dr. Heard's ideas, we'd be minus patients." So how much milk do you need? And if you can't do milk, you're going to have to work on getting your calcium from vegetables. 2 to 4 cups of milk per day. That's just a general estimate, or more. Or 3 to 6 ounces of cheese. Milk is highly, highly concentrated. Cheese even more concentrated in calcium and phosphorus, and also has fat-soluble vitamins, if it's really good grass-fed cheese. Now, it's not so much a problem here, but in some places, people don't have the cows that are always on the pasture, or the cows are fed too much grains. And that kind of milk is not going to have the same effects as the Deaf Smith County milk. The pasture has to be very fertile, have good minerals, have the excellent effects. So the quality of milk makes a big difference. I don't know if you noted, but a lot of the people who are immune to cavities in Deaf Smith County didn't just drink milk. They had soured milk. So I would encourage you, if you are a milk drinker, or maybe milk is just okay for you, to try a cultured milk, like kefir. And kefir can also help clean up your gut flora and help detoxify the body. Kefir is magic if you have the real one. Clabber, soured milk, yogurt. In ancient Ayurvedic texts, they knew the wisdom and value of raw milk, and they said, other than colostrum, the most healing form of milk to the body that heals the most conditions is buttermilk. So really encourage you to try all the varieties of milk. And it's cultured buttermilk, not regular buttermilk. Milk that's got all those good bacteria and nutrients and easy to assimilate calcium. If you guys have questions, write them down. We'll have time to answer them in a little bit. So some people get upset at this section. I'm just warning you. Even the USDA says we should be eating bran from grains, whole grain. I don't know when it became popular, but eating bran from grains may have become popular in the oat bran fad in the 1960s. And Dennis Burkitt traveled to Africa. He wrote, "Don't forget fiber in your diet." He thought that native peoples in Africa were immune to colon cancer because of the fiber in their diet. He didn't mention that many cultures in Africa significantly process their grain to remove the fiber before they eat it. Edward Mellenby did extensive studies on rickets and tooth decay. Decades. Here's what he says. Oatmeal and grain embryo interfere most strongly with building healthy teeth. Grain germ has a baneful effect on the teeth. He also noticed that, particularly the germ of the grain, caused affected the nervous system of the dogs he did experiments on. And he said, look, this isn't just in dogs, this is in people. We have pellagra from niacin deficiency from corn, and you get skin problems and dementia. We have latherism, which is immobility from a bean toxin. We have pernicious anemia, which causes leg weakness and loss of reflex from the plant toxin. We have beriberi. We have all these diseases that we know for certain are caused by the grain, by the bran and the germ, or the germ. The sprouting and souring remove these toxins. I get a lot of people, and you may, maybe some of you have had this, and they say, I take hot liver oil, my kids get raw milk, we have soup, and my kids have cavities. But my neighbor, they, you know, go to fast food, they eat white flour, and their kids don't have cavities. What's the deal? I've heard this many times. There was a woman, she had excellent, they had their own farm, excellent pastured meat, milk, they'd eat the organ meats, they'd make soup, but she had a homemade spelt sourdough with the whole grain, and her daughter had pretty bad cavities. Took out the sourdough, cavities stopped. We know about the GAPS diet that is very popular here, where to heal the body, they remove the grain. Now, my opinion of why that works is because of the plant toxins in grains that aren't removed properly because we're making it wrong. Nutrient absorption studies. Bread with eight, so you take a whole grain, bread, grind it up, remove 8%. So you're going to have some bran and some germ. They do nutrient absorption studies. Compare that with a bread that has 21% of all the weight removed. So all the bran, all the germs gone, and some of the heavier particles. The 21% bread, the bread that was more filtered from the bran and germ, the people absorbed more calcium, more phosphorus, more potassium, more magnesium from that bread. It's possible that what's causing this in grains are lectins. Some lectins, although it could be a lot more, some lectins are not destroyed by fermentation, cooking, or digestion. Indigenous cultures had another way of dealing with lectins. And if you imagine, you know, living where your life is off the food that you grow and there's no other support, why would you go through the trouble and remove the bran and the germ of grains? Because you're removing stuff that you could be eating. Why do some indigenous cultures do this? It's probably because they need to remove the toxins. So rickets, how did they produce rickets in the laboratory animal? Poor bone formation, tooth decay. Give them whole oats. You get low density bones. Now, when Edward Malmby completely removed the phytic acid from the oats, you got a much higher density bone. And the way he did that was germinating several days and then souring for 2 days. And then he had fresh oats. Causes cavities. Scurvy. Okay, why do we need to talk about scurvy? Is this important for us? Symptoms of scurvy. Tooth loss. That's common in our culture as we get older. Gum disease. 90% or more of the population has some gum disease. Many of us don't know. That's very common. And this is a symptom of scurvy and tooth decay. So maybe scurvy has something to do with why people lose their teeth or have cavities. How do you produce scurvy in the laboratory in guinea pigs? Give them whole oats, barley, corn, or soy, or all of them together. And if you sprout the barley, that's enough to prevent the scurvy from occurring. Although that I'm not saying sprouting. We'll talk about sprouting more in a little bit. And if I don't, you can ask me afterwards. What did Edward Malmby say about whole grain diets? More severe rickets developed when the diet consisted mainly of oatmeal, maize, or corn, or wheat flour, whole wheat flour. Then when these substances were replaced by equal amounts of either white flour or rice, in spite of the fact that the former cereals contain more calcium and phosphorus than the later. Even Weston Price said we should make the entire, use the whole grain. But in the experiments from Edward Mallenby, he says, even though the whole grain's got more stuff, you're not getting it. In fact, the opposite. You're getting less. So do we all have mild scurvy from whole grains? This is tooth loss over age. Average 40 to 59-year-old is missing 4 teeth. Average over 60-year-old, 8 teeth. Okay, so we're talking about laboratory animals. Maybe that doesn't apply to humans, right? Because we've got to be really careful when you take laboratory experiments and transfer them to humans. Here's an example. Scurvy produced by macrobiotic diet. So the woman nearly died from eating too much brown rice. Since scurvy and rickets are caused by a similar diet in the laboratory, maybe people would notice this. And Thomas Barlow, who infantile scurvy is named after, he said, hey, scurvy rickets. Similar, related. Weston Price fed 27 orphanage children with severe cavities. He gave them one excellent meal per day. I talk about the excellent meal. I summarize what that is in my book. But the meal had fat-soluble vitamins and minerals. The other meals the children ate contained white bread, vegetable fat, syrup, and pancakes. Did their teeth remineralize? 100% of all the children with severe cavities had them all stop, even though they still had white flour and even a vegetable fat and sugar in their diet. Why? Because flour, white flour, I'm not promoting that you should eat white flour, it has less anti-calcifying properties than a whole flour. So they got away with it because they had enough. They had a very nutrient-dense diet. One thing we know that's problematic, that causes issues, is the phytic acid in the grains. Teeth need calcium and phosphorus, which I talked about, iron, magnesium. Now, of course, they need a bunch of other stuff. These are probably the most important of the minerals. Iron deficiency is the number one deficiency in the world that we have right now. Phytic acid binds to iron. It's possible that iron deficiency is so prevalent because of improper grain and bean preparation. Phytic acid affects the absorption of these minerals, it affects the utilization of these minerals, and it can cause the excretion of these minerals, the exact minerals our body needs for healthy teeth and bones. So it would make sense if someone was eating a lot of grains or wasn't extremely careful that they could get a lot of cavities from the grains. Bran contains insoluble fiber. A lot of it is not digestible by the body. This is the outer layer of the wheat bran. I have confirmed that bran has been removed in the following cultures. Isolated French Alps, in an over 1,000-year-old recipe, they sifted out 25% of the fresh ground, the rye, and then sifted it. Removed 25% by weight. So they removed much more than the bran and the germ. They removed a lot of fibrous stuff. Then they made their soured bread. Ogi, in Africa, they removed the bran and the germ of the corn and then sour it for 1 to 3 days. Kishk, they removed the bran and the, or at least the bran of the wheat in Africa, sour it, and then combined it with a dense cultured dairy. In Tibet, I go to a Tibetan doctor, and she has a wide face and beautiful teeth and very healthy, and she's definitely a little bit older. And I said, well, did you eat grains going up? She said, oh, of course, barley. That's the only thing that grows in Tibet, and it's a special food. It's so good, they even don't even cook it sometimes. I said, well, how's this possible? How do you store it? Well, we store it in the yak skins. Well, what do you do with the bran? Oh, we don't eat the bran. The bran's poisonous. That's for the animals. And then she said, in China, millet. Millet is a sacred healing food. It's got to be prepared properly. Rice. in there's some ancient societies, in cultures in India, which are vegetarian, but they have pretty healthy teeth. And one thing they do, they follow very strict principles on everything in their food system. One thing they do with their rice is they age it for 1 year. And the aging of the rice will destroy or reduce the plant toxins and phytic acid. Other cultures, they will partially mill the rice, so they'll remove some of the bran. The bran and germ in rice is definitely much less toxic. Each grain needs its own specific preparation method. You can't take one and bring it to the other unless they're very similar. So that's one way we have to be really careful. There's no hard and fast rules, and it's very difficult to find that real safe way where I can promise you, if you eat this, it's not going to make your cavities worse. But, and that's what I've been trying to do. The cure for scurvy is the same thing that prevents the negative effects in phytic acid. It's the anti-scorbutic vitamin C, which is also considered the magic toothbrush. And there's an article on the Weston Price Foundation website about the magic toothbrush, vitamin C. Concentrated sources are berries. I like to get vitamin C from food. Camu camu, asriola, rose hips, parsley, broccoli, some vegetable sources, guavas, kiwis, red pepper. So how do you not have negative effects from eating grains if you want to eat them? Basic guideline. Instead of whole grain sourdough bread from unbleached flour. There's some bakeries that even start with the whole grain, and they do it just like the old way. They'll grind it, remove the bran, because they say, it tastes better. Moderate your consumption of nuts and seeds, soaked or unsoaked. Soaked, dehydrated nuts and seeds taste great, but if you have cavities and want to stop them, definitely want to be careful with those. If you don't have cavities, do whatever you want. Store-bought grain products. People really get into trouble. This is sprouted bread. It's safe to eat. Sprouted bread from the store, not safe. Any product that has bran or germ added that's in the store. One particular ones to be concerned are the gluten-free products, which are filled with brown rice or rice bran. Don't eat those. I wrote an article in Wise Traditions. It's on the website if you need more information on grains. I also have a pretty detailed explanation in my book. Advanced. So, okay, you want to prepare it at home. You want to do advanced guidelines, fresh grind your grains. In general, you want to remove the bran and germ of the grain. So you have these great soaking, souring recipes like in Nourishing Traditions. Remove the bran and the germ. Wheat, spelt, kamut, barley, rye, definitely. Oats, I don't know. Haven't found the exact recipe, so maybe. Quinoa, buckwheat, and amaranth are not true grains. They're pseudo-cereals. Maybe whole is okay for them. I don't want to promise that because I haven't found that old recipe from someone who doesn't have tooth decay that's been eating these grains for a long time where I know exactly how they prepared it. Were those possibly safe? And rice is in the middle. You get to decide. You could do brown rice, and then you want to do the brown rice with the starter. That's in the Wise Traditions article, and that's on a Whole Health blogspot. The instructions are in my book. So rice doesn't have the enzyme phytase. We need phytase to get rid of the phytic acid. So soaking rice does not eliminate phytic acid. In general, if you're having grains at home, you want soured grains. Advanced nut preparation is to roast them and eat them with proteins, because that's what a lot of indigenous people cook their nuts. Don't eat extra wheat germ or bran. One of the worst cases of cavities I ever heard, this woman, and she went to a dentist every 6 months. They're just full surgery on the kid, then they have to do it again 6 months later, root canals, everything. And she gave her child extra bran and germ in the morning smoothie. So sprouting in the best laboratory conditions removes about 50% of the phytic acid. That's just a general, that's laboratory conditions. It's part of a grain preparation. I wouldn't say it's the end result. How you need to prepare your grains really depends on how much you eat. There's people here, they have the whole grain and so forth, but they have two small servings a week. If you don't have a lot, you're not getting a lot of plant toxins. It's probably not going to be a big deal, but if it's a little, it's a kid who's maybe a little deficient, it could be severe, or someone who's got more imbalances, a little bit of whole grains can be really bad. So how you deal with whole grains in your diet, that's your choice, but there's ways and principles to balance the grains no matter how you prepare them. Vitamin C. So in countries that eat rice, in order to balance their rice intake, they have green vegetables rich in vitamin C. And vitamin C blocks the anti-nutritional factors in grains. Some of them, at least. Calcium. In the Swiss Alps, where they have the rye bread, every bread meal has cheese and milk. The cheese provides calcium. The phosphorus wants calcium to go with it. They like to be with each other. Even if it's perfectly no phytic acid, whatever grain, it still likes calcium to balance. The other thing they did in the Swiss Alps is they had milk with their meals. Milk has vitamin C. Pasteurized milk has absolutely no vitamin C. So bread and cheese with raw milk. Another tradition from India, you have your lentils or your beans, you have it with cheese or yogurt. Vitamin D. So Edward Mallaby found that vitamin D caused less excretion of calcium and phosphorus. Vitamin D is the cure for rickets. So when you have foods that contain vitamin D, it's going to limit any negative effects from grains, no matter how you prepare the grains. But there's a ceiling on how much vitamin D can help you. So if you had a bran, germ-rich diet, vitamin D will only help to a certain point. These are the bad guys, corn syrup, now called corn sugar. There's a connection with the rise of obesity and heart disease. The average American has almost 100 pounds of corn syrup per year. The corn syrup, when you eat sugar, it gets converted into blood sugar. Now, if you have a lot of blood sugar fluctuations over time, it causes calcium and phosphorus to be depleted in your system. The more concentrated the sugar, the more severe the fluctuation, the more likely tooth decay will result. Because corn syrup, the fructose in the corn syrup is not totally natural, it doesn't get converted into blood sugar very well. It gets processed in our liver, it gets converted into blood fructose. And they play little games because it's similar to fructose, but slightly different, so they say it's the same, but it's not. It's very toxic. Go really quickly over sweeteners that demineralize your body. So again, if the sweetener is too prolonged or too concentrated, blood sugar gets imbalanced, minerals get out of balance. If you have severe cavities like tooth infections, no sugar. Moderate cavities, just a tiny bit of sugar. Natural sugar. Anything that says white sugar, cane sugar, evaporated cane juice. So it's probably the best of the processed sugars. You don't want to eat these, though, if you have cavities. Xylitol and erythritol. Yes, some dentists say that xylitol does great stuff. But this is a synthetic sugar. Agave nectar, rich in fructose. See article in Wise Traditions if you need more details. With these new sweeteners, they pretend to be this native sweetener, which actually exists, but that's not what's in the marketplace. The native sweetener would cost a lot, like $20, $30 a pound. Health food bars is even in like NBC News. Health food bars cause cavities. Maybe someone here is making a good one. Don't eat health food bars if you don't want to have cavities. Yukon syrup, another one, is a real sweetener. Don't trust what's in the store. Lohan, palm sugar, coconut sugar, tropical traditions. They says on their website, we don't do coconut sugar because it's not a sustainable practice. It would be expensive to have real coconut sugar. You have to harvest it from the bud. What most of the ways these sugars are probably made is they take the pulp, throw it into the enzyme converters, and it makes sugar just like you would do with corn. Corn thing. Stevia extract. So there's stevia concentrate, stevia extract. Extract, very bad. glycerin, fructose. So there's extracts, tinctures, and whatever that have glycerin. You don't want to eat glycerin. Might be okay for your skin. Inulin. Fructooligosaccharides, another word for fructose. Brown rice syrup, potentially a safe sweetener, but what's in the store, probably not safe. Avoid brown rice syrup, my suggestion. Malted barley and grain sweeteners, just like grains have a really bad effect on your teeth, grain sweeteners have a bad effect on your teeth. Maltodextrin, sucrose, dextrose, sucralose, aspartame, saccharin, more names of fake sugars to avoid. We don't want these sugars. Okay, jams and dried fruit. If you don't have cavities, sure, have jam and dried fruit. If you do, it's very concentrated sugar. You need to avoid it. You want to have maybe one sweet meal per day if you have cavities, or no sweet meals. And the sweet I would recommend would be a little piece of fruit. If you don't know what the sweetener is or feel unsure about it, don't buy it. Not try it out and see how you like it. We have amazing sweeteners in our culture. They're abundant. We don't need more. We have organic maple syrup. We'll have raw honey. We have stevia. Only get stevia if you know it's the herb, the powder with the little particles. Not refined, not extracted. You have to be really careful with stevia because it's easy to get the toxic one. Rapadura. And there's a brand of sugar, Heavenly Sugar, which is a very clean cane sugar from India. So we have great natural sweeteners. If you need a sweetener, use one of these. Unless you see lab studies that the other one doesn't cause any health effects. So I spent all summer rewriting my book to include the latest information. Just want to tell you what's in there if you're interested. Dentistry's inability to cure cavities. Dentist Weston Price discovers the cure for cavities. How to make your teeth strong with fat-soluble vitamins. How to remineralize your teeth with wise food choices. This is a chapter outline. Nutritional protocols to remineralize cavities. How to stop cavities with your next meal. How to have healthy gums. The high price of conventional dentistry. Your bite. How your teeth can heal naturally. And how to heal children's cavities. And just a little teaser is in the recipe section. I don't know if you heard of the people doing these raw green smoothies that are supposed to be so great. I have a cooked green smoothie based on Ayurvedic principles. So you eliminate the plant toxins, but still get all the minerals. A lot of people don't know about my other book, Healing Our Children, which Weston Price had a very important message for mothers and parents, and I think people missed it. It's in his book, but it's hard to get. I summarized the message and it made it clear by using 44 of his photographs. I also have information on indigenous parenting methods, homeschooling, and vaccinations. So just wanted to let you know about that. Weston Price says, tooth decay is not only unnecessary, but an indication of our divergence from nature's fundamental laws of life and health. What are the fundamental laws? Eat fat-soluble vitamins, have enough minerals. Live in harmony, live in balance, pay attention to your soils. That's the fundamental laws. When we disobey the laws, we get disease. Obey the laws, disease usually heals. So, society and ourselves are maybe at a choice point. Continue with the old way. Let the dentist fix your problems. And don't worry about what you eat. The new way, which will be 95% or more effective in remineralizing cavities, change how you eat, and take health into your own hand. So this is all based on the belief that I don't think we're here to be suffering in disease. I think we're here to heal disease. Thank you. So about a little less than 15 minutes for questions, and then we have a 10-minute break. Go ahead.
I had a question for you about making your own almond meal. I get
almond meal?
Almond flour.
Okay.
So I get the unpasteurized almonds actually from Italy still.
Yeah.
And then I soak them with sea salt and dehydrate them and grind them up myself.
Okay.
And just your thoughts on that, because we do gluten-free and I don't like any other the junk out there, so I just do almond flour. And just what your thoughts are on that.
Well, nuts are very rich in phytic acid. But interestingly, not all nuts will block your iron absorption, such as coconut. Coconut does have phytic acid, but it doesn't have a negative effect on how much iron is in your body. If you have cavities, I definitely would not eat very much almond flour. If you don't, it's okay. Roasting the nuts, like another example is you go to a gourmet food store and have these de-skinned roasted almonds that you eat with cheese. So you have the calcium and combine with the nuts and it tastes amazing. So if you wanted to continue with that, I would try roasting the nuts before you did the rest. But not encouraged for cavities.
He's gluten intolerant. Also, I changed his toothpaste to Good Gums because, I don't know, they say there's like a glycerin seal with the regular toothpaste. But we do have eat grains, but I soak them. But I think that must be it. That I'm giving, and we drink raw milk, of course, and cod liver oil, so I don't know what's going on. He has lots of cavities.
It could be that. Another thing is that it makes a big difference how the teeth are formed in the womb. So there's children that are born with very strong teeth, and there's children that are born with weak teeth that are more sensitive. So your child is very sensitive. You have to be extra careful. I don't have time to try to figure out what exactly it is, but it could be that. It could be other things as well. But keep looking, because you can find the answer. There is a solution. It's not just like it goes on forever and it's fate.
I haven't really filled his cavities. I'm trying
well,
to find
the
a
best
solution.
You could expect is those would really slow down or get hard. Try the butter oil or the skate liver oil. Take out the grains. Make sure there's very little sweets and see if that helps. And plenty of mineral soups.
Thank you so much. What if you already have a tooth that the doctor is saying that the only option is a root canal and it's starting to bother you? Is the only choice to actually pull the teeth out? And then if we do pull the teeth out, then what is there to worry about afterwards? Thank you.
Conventional dentistry is, I don't know if bad is the right word. They want to do 30 million root canals per year, or they're already doing it. That's their standard. So everything is root canal, root canal, root canal. The first thing I would recommend is get another opinion. I have links on my website or in the book to find an excellent dentist.
What if there's already a discomfort in a tooth?
That can be healed. I wouldn't promise you it's healed. The worse the tooth is off, the harder it is to heal. So do your best with diet. This is there's a lot of these gray areas, and what I say is make your diet as best as you can. Monitor it with the dentist. Find a good dentist that you feel good about, that's trying to preserve your tooth, not just do root canal because it hurts a little bit. And see what you can do. See what the result is. Sometimes it hurts, it has nothing to do with the tooth. Maybe it's some gum issue or jawbone issue. And you ask, or should you do root canal or extract it? My opinion is to take the absolute most conservative approach, and that is only pull a tooth if you have to. Only do a root canal if you absolutely have to. Only do a crown if you absolutely have to. That's my opinion. And in the end, it's your choice. It's not the dentist's choice. You do what you want. If you don't want to have a root canal, don't get one. If you want the tooth pulled, have it pulled. If you don't want it pulled, don't. It's your decision. It's not the dentist's decision. But what they do is they trick people, they put fear in there, and you can't think. And they say, here's the only option, root canal. You have the mic. Okay. They have questions here.
Quick question. I have a 3-year-old, and we have a real sweet dentist around the corner. Would you recommend not even going to a regular dentist at all? And
some of the old school, there's some old school dentists who have been around for a long time that are pretty good, and they say, hey, you know, it's a child's cavity, don't worry, we'll keep an eye on it, see what's going on, because they know that you don't want to treat those.
And how often do you recommend for kids?
To go to a dentist? As much as you want to. So you don't want to avoid what's going on here. It's good to know because it's an indication of how your diet is. It's an indication if you're having bite or other health problems. You want to know what's going on with your teeth. How you know, that's your choice. Home care, x-rays, pictures, muscle testing, that's your choice. If you find a good dentist, yeah, the dentists are experts at finding the cavities. So if you find one that you like and just have them look, and you see any cavities, they do a quick check. That's, I think, a good way to go. It's just to find the dentist that you feel good about who's not over-prescribing treatments. They had two questions. And then... Oh, my gosh. 5 minutes.
I'm just wondering how, like, I've, you know, sat in a lot of seminars this whole time here, and everybody's leaning to the same thing, even though we know about price and the grains and that some cultures did use grains, but there's like, I can think of 4, 5, or 6 presentations that were, they all lean toward not eating very much grains, and if you do, here's how to try to incorporate them if you're not too unhealthy. But is, would you say if the ideal thing is meat, veggies, or meat, cultured veggies, raw milk, is it ideal to leave out the grains? Like, do we have to, is there any reason at all to try incorporate grains? Or, like, can we just skip that? Like, is anybody willing to say, just don't eat them?
Okay, if you're sick.
We don't need them. Like, nothing we need them for, right?
Your kid's got autism or behavioral problems, the kid's got bad cavities, you have a tooth infection, avoiding grains is good. But grains are also medicine. Grains are also probably what led to the evolution of humanity. Humans have been using grains at least 30,000 years. They just put evidence of this, mortar and pestle. We want to have the grains. We just have to be so careful on how we make them.
Do I need them for anything?
What?
Like, there's no reason I should include them other than that I maybe like them.
It's optional. Some people go, yeah, I never liked grains. But some people like the grain. So, yeah, there's healthy cultures that never had grains. The Eskimos, Canadian Indians, only have a few minutes. These two guys, get some of these. Try to go quick.
Thank you. What do you brush your teeth with if you brush them?
Okay, so when you do the normal brushing, the plaque in your mouth goes up into the gums and causes gum recession because the plant is toxic. Yeah, there's some people who do brush down. So I clean the gums out with a technique that I mentioned in the book. Don't have time to talk about it now. Brush first, clean the gums out, and clean the whole mouth. And what do you use? Sea salt, tooth soap, just basically not toothpaste. That's my suggestion.
And as we're passing, how did you get your daughter to eat nutrient-dense foods?
We just took out the grains because that. What happens is if you eat a lot of grains not properly prepared, you can develop, let's say, grain hypersensitivity, and because you don't have the protective nutrients. And so we just took them out. And then her system got stronger, give her good vitamins, give her liver, be persistent. Sometimes you need bribery. You get your fruit after you drink your milk.
Okay, so do you talk more in the book about gum disease? Because you're focusing so much on tooth decay.
I have a chapter on gum disease that will help people with moderate or less.
And if it's severe, they feel like...
Severe, you need to work with someone who's an expert, and then you can use those strategies as a supplementary treatment.
Just anecdotally, I know a bunch of people who do the paleo diet where they don't eat any grains at all, ever, like for the rest of their life, not even like gaps where it's temporary. And those people have said how they go to the dentist, and the dentist's like, you must be flossing now, and that their gums look a lot better. So I'm of the opinion that you don't need grains at all, but that's, we can talk more later.
Do, and then I think
You mentioned earlier about drinking milk. Is that only cow's milk? I can't have cow's milk, but is there the same benefit with sheep or goat milk?
I think the fat-soluble vitamin concentration is different, but you'll get the good minerals. And that's what so you want to make sure you're getting the fat-soluble vitamins elsewhere, but for your good calcium phosphorus source, yeah.
I just wanted to mention that I've been having grass-fed butter for like over a year. It's the only thing I could tolerate from cow. And I thought it was my imagination that my teeth actually felt better. They felt more solid and smooth.
That's exactly what happened. He wants to ask one or two more, and that's we don't have more time because we have the next speaker.
Can you tell us the relationship between a pH and cavity development?
There's different levels of the pH in the mouth, and when it's more alkaline, there's no cavities, and then it keeps going down. When you have a more acidic mouth, then there's a severe cavities, acidic mouth. But the body is in control of the pH, so I see pH as symptom, not cause.
The dentist has told me that I have like two cracked teeth that need root canals. Can cracked teeth be healed?
Sometimes they can. I would encourage to look into maybe lasers or different vibrational therapies to encourage the healing. And they have to be very, not have bite stress on them. We're pretty much out of time. So here's the deal with questions. Ask the questions at lunch. I have my books out there if anyone wants them. I'm leaving after lunch. And we have about a 10-minute break. Thank you.
Thank you. It is a delight to be here. I just have a wonderful feeling about this conference. It's a great atmosphere here. How many of you are new to these ideas here for the first time? And you're in the right place because this is the introduction to everything else. So we're delighted to have you and hope you have a wonderful conference. And we're going to get started. I have a tremendous amount of material to present to you. And we may even go a few minutes late on each session, so just bear with me. And I may talk fast. Please hold your questions to the end, and I will stay as late as you like in the afternoon to answer questions. Or if you catch me during the breaks, you know, I'm always happy to answer questions. There's a big buzz about being healthy and about healthy food. It is the subject of the 21st century. But there's a big question. What actually is a healthy diet? You always hear people talking about eating healthily, but just what do they mean when they say a healthy diet? Because what our government says is healthy and what we say is healthy are very different. So what is a healthy diet? Is it the Atkins-type diet based on lots of meat? Is it a vegetarian-vegan diet, which is very popular today? A lot of claims, amazing claims made about vegetarianism. Or is it one of these other types of dietary schemes? And I do call them schemes. Where you have a different diet depending on your blood type or your metabolism, or you have to meticulously count your carbs or your fats, or food combining. I call these schemes, they were all thought up by men who never had to feed a hungry family day after day. And I don't care what your blood type is or your metabolic type. When you sit down to my dinner, you're going to eat what I put in front of you. So, of course, the opposite or the other part of that equation is that what you put in front of them needs to taste good, needs to be delicious. So even Lisa Simpson, who's a very smart little girl, is very confused about what constitutes a healthy diet. We also have the official U.S. government diet, which is popularized with this food pyramid based on 7 to 11 servings of carbohydrate foods every day. And it has led to an epidemic of obesity. This same diet is promoted by another part of USDA as a way of fattening cattle. So they know that this diet is good for making humans or animals fat. And make no mistake, there's no science behind this. These guidelines are not based on science or based on the way any traditional culture eats. But they were. It was put together and designed to promote the products of commodity agriculture. So to answer the question, what is a healthy diet, we need to go back in time to the work of Dr. Weston Price, for whom our foundation is named. He is the author of this wonderful book, Nutrition and Physical Degeneration, which chronicles his 10 years of studies of isolated traditional cultures. Dr. Price was a dentist. He was one of the foremost dentists of his day. He was head of research for the National Dental Association. He wrote dental textbooks. He wrote a textbook for the Navy. He wrote 1,000 pages on the dangers of root canals. He was a prolific writer and researcher, widely published in peer-reviewed journals. He was a man who asked probing questions. And the question he kept asking himself was, why are my patients so sick? Why am I seeing rampant decay and infection in people's mouths? And even more importantly, why am I seeing people with dental deformities? That was the word he used for crooked teeth, crowded and crooked teeth. Why do I see people who don't have enough room in their jaws for all their teeth, who suffer from overbites and underbites and so forth? And he noted that people who had dental problems invariably suffered from other health problems. So he reasoned that if he could answer the question, what kind of diet promotes good dental health, that same diet would promote good overall health. Now, this was a time back in the early 1930s, late 1920s, when the world was opening up. We had new modes of transportation. We had a new invention called the camera. And there were explorers and anthropologists going to remote corners of the world and studying these isolated peoples. And one of the first observations they made, something that struck them when they entered these communities, was what beautiful teeth people had. Beautiful, broad, straight teeth. The painter George Catlin in the 1800s, who painted Native Americans, described their teeth as broad and straight and white as piano keys. And Dr. Price was hearing the same thing. And you can imagine that this interested him very much, because this is not what he was seeing in his practice. So Dr. Price decided to go on to do a study, which turned out to last 10 years and take him to many different parts of the globe. And he wanted to answer two questions in this study. First of all, was it true? Were there really people living in isolation without the help of dentists or doctors and all the marvels of modern technology who had perfect dental health, no cavities, no dental deformities, and by inference, good overall health? And if he could answer this first question with a yes, the second question was, what were these people eating? What kind of diet did these healthy people have? He wasn't interested in the diets of unhealthy people. He knew what unhealthy people were eating. He wanted to know what the diets of healthy people looked like. And that was the genius of Dr. Price. He asked the right questions, and then he very persistently and carefully sought the answer to these questions. Now, the first place that Dr. Price went was Switzerland. He was only able to study two European cultures, because isolated Europeans were fast disappearing. Switzerland had embarked on a huge campaign of road building to connect all the villages and towns in Switzerland. But there were still a few villages that had no roads connecting them. They were at the very far end of the Loenthal Valley, which was surrounded by very steep mountain ranges. And the only access to these little villages at this end of the valley was a footpath too narrow for a wheeled cart. So he could be assured that all of the foods that they ate in this village were foods grown and processed in the village, with one exception, and that was salt. They had no salt there, and they had to carry salt in. When he came to a village or a tribe, he always found an interpreter, and he sat down with the elders. He asked their permission, and when he got their permission, he then lined up every individual in the village, young and old, no exceptions, and looked in every mouth and meticulously counted cavities. He left us a fantastic record of dental decay and or lack thereof among traditional peoples. He took notes about the shape of the jaw, whether or not they had dental deformities. And that part of his research was extremely precise and scientific. He then took more general notes about the overall health of these people. He described the foods that they ate, and then he took samples of the foods back to his laboratory in Cleveland and analyzed them for nutrient vitamins and minerals. So that's how Dr. Price worked. So you can, let's see, got a new clicker here. So here he is in the village, and the first thing he does is look at the children. He lines all the children up and looks in their mouths, and you can imagine the amazement of the dentist from Cleveland opening all these mouths, and he had to look in three mouths before he found even one tooth that was decayed. You can bring that, me a glass, okay, thank you. So there was less than 1% tooth decay among the children and the adults in this isolated Swiss village. And they had no toothbrushes here, no toothpaste, no fluoridated water, no dentists, no fluoride treatments, but they had virtually no tooth decay. Yeah, you can just pour me a little glass of that. This is the Grainfields drink. It really gives you lots of energy. We'll talk about this later. And the other amazing thing was that all these children had naturally straight teeth. There was nobody in this village that needed braces. They had broad faces, strikingly broad faces, broad noses, broad nostrils, lots of air could be breathed in the, high mountains. Thank you very much. This wonderful photograph, which was released just a few years ago by the Price-Pottinger Nutrition Foundation, it's a little bit hard to see, but the children's faces are very round. And they have a lot of space, especially in the middle third of the face, what you would call high cheekbones, which is, of course, a sign of attractiveness. The children were very sturdy and strong. They played barefoot in the freezing cold water of the streams coming off the mountains during weather in which Dr. Price and his wife had to button up their heavy overcoats. In talking to the health officials of Switzerland, they told him that they had never known of a single case of tuberculosis in this village. And this was a time when tuberculosis was the number one health problem throughout Switzerland and indeed throughout the world. The men in the village were noted for their great strength. They routinely won the athletic contests held throughout Switzerland, and the women from this village were noted for their beauty. So here we have a population where he could answer that first question with a yes. They had excellent dental health, and by all that he could determine, excellent overall health. So the next question is, what were they eating? The number one source of calories in this diet was the same food that was accused of causing tuberculosis throughout the world, raw milk. They kept cattle and goats who grazed on the lush green pastures beneath the melting glaciers. And they consumed the raw milk, they made raw cheese, had raw butter, and raw cream. Cream was considered very important for the athletes during their athletic contests. They didn't do carb loading, they drank bowls of pure cream, so very high fat diet. The other main source of calories in the diet was grain. They grew rye in the short summer months, and they made a very dense sourdough rye bread. Typical lunch for the children going to school would be a thick slice of this heavy bread and an equally thick slice of the raw cheese on the bread. And this is, again, very interesting because one of the theories that we have out there about why we have so many health problems today is that we're eating these two foods that are new to human beings, to the human species, dairy foods and grains. And yet here was a superbly healthy population living on dairy foods and grains. But the dairy foods were very different from the dairy foods we buy in the supermarket today, and the grains were processed and handled with much more care than the grain products that we buy today. These people did eat meat. Any population that eats dairy foods eats meat, at least occasionally, because they have animals that get old and they slaughter the young male animals. And they mostly ate veal. And as with any traditional culture that eats meat, nothing goes to waste. They ate the organ meats. They used the bones to make soup. They ate the fats. No one was there to tell them that the fats were bad. And they had and they tasted good. The fats tasted good, so of course they ate them. They did grow some vegetables in the short summer months, but they didn't have a lot of vegetables and certainly no fruit in the diet. It was mainly animal foods and grains. Now, every culture that he went to had one or more sacred foods. The sacred foods were foods considered very important for men and women before conception, for women when they were pregnant, breastfeeding, and for children when they were growing. Every population that he went to recognized the need for extra nutrition to form and grow a new human being. And this is the wisdom of these people really puts us to shame. We tend to leave all these things to chance in modern culture. The sacred food among the Swiss villagers was a special type of butter. It was the butter that came from the cows when they first went to pasture in the spring. This butter was a deep orange color. And they actually had a ceremony where they put a bowl of butter on the altar in their church and lit a wick in the butter to honor the life-giving force in the butter. So I look forward to the day when we do this in all of our churches. Here's a picture of the bread. Normal loaves were quite a bit smaller. This is a festival loaf for Easter. And that loaf of bread will weigh, 20, 25 pounds, very dense. They put a hole in the bread, and so they can hang it on a hook. The actual process of making the bread takes a few days. It's a very slow sourdough process. And then they hang it for at least 2 weeks to allow it to cure or to age, just like a ham or a bottle of wine. We recently learned that actually in these villages, they only made bread twice a year. And so this bread lasted for 6 months hanging up like that. Have a look at the beautiful facial structure of the woman. What Dr. Price referred to as the middle third of the face is very broad. She has some very high cheekbones. This is the facial construction that we associate with beauty. The old actresses in the old black and white movies had this type of facial structure. It's disappeared today. We don't see that anymore. She's nice and slender in spite of their high fat diet. And what I like best about this photograph is the hat. Isn't it beautiful? Now, everywhere that Dr. Price went, he could observe a world in transition, from the primitive peoples on their traditional foods to modernized people eating Western processed foods. And when he went to the villages in Switzerland where there was a road, there was invariably food stores. There weren't food stores in the primitive villages. Nobody bought food. They raised their own food. So there were food stores. And these stores contained what he called the displacing foods of modern commerce. So these were not only empty foods, but they were pushing out the nutrient-dense foods that they had eaten before. So this is jams and jellies and pastries, chocolates, white bread, canned foods, canned condensed milk, and another new factor in the Western diet, vegetable oils, something completely new to the human diet. Here, when he examined people's mouths, he found one tooth in three was decayed. So you've gone from less than 1% to 33% tooth decay. So lots of missing teeth. But even more of more concern to him, the children who were born after the parents changed their diet, basically after the road came to the village, did not have as broad a face, and there was not enough room in the jaw for the teeth to come in straight. So they had dental deformities. And he noted that the children with dental deformities were much more susceptible to diseases like tuberculosis. The other European group that he was able to study were some Gaelic people living off the coast of Scotland in the Outer Hebrides. This particular island that he visited had no commerce with the outside world. Here he found a very hardy, healthy population, virtually no tooth decay, no tuberculosis. And what struck him most was the good humor and spirituality of these people. No one had to lock a door. everyone seemed to get along, and a very gregarious, talkative population. Now, these people lived on this foggy, windswept island. They could not keep animals there, so there was no meat in the diet, no eggs, no dairy foods. There were no vegetables in the diet, no fruit. They couldn't grow fruit, no broccoli. How could they possibly be healthy without broccoli? So what in the world were these people eating? Well, the number one source of calories in this diet was seafood, and not just the skinless fillets of the fish. They ate the heads, they ate the livers, they separated the oil of the livers and ate that. They had shellfish. They did have one green food, which was seaweed, and they also raised oats on the island, which they made into porridge and oat cakes. So this was a diet based on seafood and oats. And the sacred food, the food that children got every morning for breakfast to make sure they grew up healthy and strong, was, not quite, it was cod's head stuffed with oats and chopped cod's liver. Eat your breakfast, dear. These people lived in stone cottages covered with thatch, and they did not have chimneys in their cottages. So these people were living in smoky cottages all winter long. They had no lung disease, living in this secondhand smoke. And we will come back to this theme. It's a very interesting question. Why didn't they get lung cancer? Why didn't they have TB when they were basically smoking all day long, you know, breathing in smoke? But it was very important not to have chimneys, because during the winter, the thatch became blackened with the smoke, and that was their fertilizer. And in the spring, they took the thatch off and spread it on the fields, and that was their fertilizer. Dr. Price took some of the island soil home with him and planted oats in the soil. This is oats planted in the island soil with no fertilizer added. These four pots had various types of commercial fertilizer added, and this pot had the blackened thatch added, and it was the only pot that got a mature crop of oats. Now, as these people became modernized on other islands where the foods had started to come in, tuberculosis became a big problem, and the health workers said, well, you need to put chimneys in your cottages so you're not breathing in smoke all the time, and they made the people put in chimneys, which did not solve the problem and did not answer the question why it was that these very primitive Gaelic people had no lung disease, even though they were living in smoke all day long. Dr. Price went to Alaska into the hinterlands, where he found superb examples of human form, and he often talked about, he would say, superb physical specimens. Beautiful broad faces. He described her teeth as two rows of pearls. You can see the very wonderful facial structure. The babies were very sturdy and strong. They were alert, curious. They were very serious, stared at him. You see how this baby is staring. But they never cried. He never heard crying babies in these traditional cultures. Here is another set of photographs. Dr. Price, by the way, took all these photographs. Many of these Eskimos had missing teeth or worn down teeth because they chewed on leather to make their clothes, and the leather, they had sand and grit. But even these worn down teeth, just almost worn down to the pulp, were not decayed. He found virtually no tooth decay among the primitive Eskimos. And he met a doctor who had spent 30 years in Alaska. And this doctor told him that he had never seen cancer, heart disease, any condition requiring an operation among the primitive Eskimos eating their traditional food. And he said the women gave birth so easily that it was impossible to get to a birth of an Eskimo woman. If they called the doctor, by the time he got there, she'd already had her baby. Very often the women gave birth at night when their husbands were asleep, and when the husband woke up the next morning, she would introduce him to the new baby. This was in sharp contrast to the situation in the towns where they were eating the white man's food, which was being brought in. The first thing that happened was a rampant tooth decay. And here's the thing. The foods that caused the tooth decay had arrived in these villages, but the dentists hadn't gotten there yet. So there was tremendous pain from this tooth decay, and they became prone to suicide. And the reason given for suicide was the pain of tooth decay. But it was the next generation that gave Dr. Price the most cause for concern, because the children who were born after the parents changed their diet had dental deformities. There was not enough room in the jaw for the teeth to come in straight. So all of a sudden you're seeing dental deformities in a population that had none before. So this is not a genetic problem. This is a nutritional problem. And he noted in every culture that those who had dental deformities were more susceptible to other types of diseases. So going back to the healthy traditional Eskimo, we want to ask, what kind of diet did they eat? The number one source of calories in this diet was animal fat. And this is not fish oil, but seal oil. So this is the fat of a mammal, which they're carrying here, actually in the stomach of the seal. They used the seal oil for cooking. They used it for food storage. They used it for a dip or a dressing for their food. And they also had a special dish where they whipped up the ice cream, seal oil till it was frothy, added a few berries, and that was the Eskimo ice cream for special occasions. Naturally, they ate a lot of game, both sea mammals and land mammals. And they did have one food combining rule, and that was that they never ate lean meat. And we find this actually all over the world. We found Stefansson, who lived with the Indians in Canada, said the same thing. They hunted the animals selectively. They wanted older, fat animals so they could get the fat. And when the hunting was good, they actually threw the lean meat away. What they saved of the lean meat was cut into strips and dried and smoked, and then when they went to eat it, they spread it with the fat. They also ate the fatty organs first, the brain, the marrow, the liver, and the tongue. So there was a tremendous emphasis put on the fat of the animal. They had a lot of fish in the diet, and the way they prepared the fish is most interesting. Very often they would throw the fish into a hole in the ground and cover it with earth or grass, and allow the fish to ferment until it became sort of the consistency of ice cream. This is how they got their calcium, because they were eating the fermented fish bones. The reason they ate fermented foods was they noted that if they gave fresh fish to their dogs, the dogs could not pull the sleds all day long. But if they gave the fish fermented fish, then the dogs had the stamina and strength to pull their sleds all day long. So they were great observers of nature. And they realized that if they ate this semi-rotten fish, that they too would have strength and stamina. And this is another thing we're going to find all over the world, the use of fermented foods to give you strength and stamina. We'll talk about why. So very, very few plant foods in this diet. About 80% of calories came from fat. And so it was a diet based on game and fish. The sacred food among the Eskimos was salmon roe, salmon eggs. And when they asked them why they went to such trouble to dry these salmon eggs, as they're drying in the sun here, they said, "We need these salmon eggs so we can have healthy babies." And it's quite amazing how much of the fish eggs that they ate. If you hear Honora Jones on Sunday, she gives a very interesting presentation on the Eskimo foods. Dr. Price spent a lot of time among Native Americans. The chapter in his book on Native Americans is fascinating. Now, these are not his photographs. These are famous photographs of a Navajo youth and Chief Sitting Bull, and you can see the beautiful facial structure. The truly primitive Native Americans were very tall. The natives of Texas were described as averaging over 7 feet tall. Very hardy. Texas Indians never wore clothes, even in the winter, and their favorite activity on a winter morning was to break the ice in a pond and all go swimming without any clothes on, of course. Remember that the Native Americans did not have the horse until the white man arrived. They hunted on foot, and they could outrun a deer. So strong and fleet they were. These are photographs of Dr. Price of Native Americans living in Canada. You can see the uniformly good dental structure, a virtual absence of tooth decay, and he did not find any signs of any kind of disease or illness among these people. And they lived almost exclusively on animal foods, and they had the same food combining rule. They never ate lean meat. What they mostly wanted from the animals that they killed was the organ meats and the fat. And this was the tragic contrast between the modernized Indians living on reservations, eating the handout commodity foods. They suffered from tremendous tooth decay, and then in the next generation, you had the narrowing of the face. They were shorter, they tended to be overweight, and much more susceptible to disease. And Native Americans are particularly susceptible to diabetes because they have this slow metabolism that allowed them to prevail in very difficult conditions, go a long time without food if they didn't have it. But if they're on the modern diet, that makes them very susceptible to diabetes. These are Seminole Indians living in the Florida Everglades. Dr. Price was there before the land rush, the real estate boom. And once again, you can see this beautiful facial structure. These look like princes and princesses, very noble-looking faces. And this is the normal facial structure of human beings. This is the way that everyone is supposed to look. This is what our genetics provides for. But whether or not our bodies are built to express that, to have that full expression of the genetics, depends on the building materials, that is the diet. And here we have, if we go back, let's see, to our Indian princess here, beautiful broad face. This woman is from the same tribe, so this is the same genetics, but her parents were eating processed food and she grew up on processed food. So you see the narrowing of the face, the crowding of the teeth. And the teeth tell the tale, because if this were just a matter of having crooked teeth, well, we just take our kids, you know, why bother? Why not just eat junk food? We just take our kids to the orthodontist and straighten the teeth, right? But the teeth are the visible sign of the entire structure of the body. And when the teeth are crooked, it's a sign that there's been compromise in other parts of the body as the body was created and built. So when the teeth are straight, it means that there's plenty of room in the head for these critical master organs in the head, the pituitary, the pineal, and the hypothalamus. Now, the hypothalamus is the seat of impulse control. And what are we seeing in our children today? In the violence and the behavior problems, it's lack of impulse control. And when we think of the stolid Native American able to go through many privations without showing emotion and so forth, that's impulse control. That's a very good, strong hypothalamus. When the teeth are straight, it's a sign that there's been good development of the entire skeletal system, good musculature, you tend to see very good posture, keen eyesight and hearing. I have a little question now. How many people in this room need corrective lenses? How many people do not need corrective lenses? So about 10 to 15%. Now, if we collectively were a tribe having to depend on our hunting skills, we would not survive with only 15% with perfect eyesight. Optimal function of all the organs, so all the organs, the heart, the pancreas, the liver, the kidneys, etc., have been built properly and work at optimal function. And then the brain. The brain is a physical object, and there's a whole chemistry of behavior and feeling good. That depends on good nutrition. And Dr. Price found a very optimistic, cheerful people. And finally, when the head is broad, when the face is broad, the pelvic opening is round. And that is the ideal shape for a baby to get out. That's the shape that's going to give you the most surface area. When the teeth are crowded, there's compromised space in the head. The head is more narrow. There's not enough space for the these organs may be compromised or squeezed. You tend to see poor development, poor posture. People are easily injured. poor eyesight and hearing, compromised function of one or more of the organs. And then you start to see the depression, behavior problems, learning problems. That is a nutritional problem. And finally, the pelvic opening, instead of being round, is kind of squished. So it's oval. And that makes childbirth much more difficult. And we, you know, I'm not critical of all these cesareans that are being done. Some of them may be unnecessary, but most of them are absolutely life-saving. And I think we don't realize what we're saying when we criticize the cesarean, because before that came along and before the modern methods of child delivery, childbirth in industrial cultures was life-threatening to women. You know, one birth in 10 ended in a very, very agonizingly painful death of the mother. So we need to kind of put all this in perspective. Dr. Price went to the South Seas, where he made a point of going to isolated islands. This is my favorite page in his book. The beautiful facial structure and dental structure of these young men on an isolated South Sea island. And these are teenagers. These are teenage boys. Our teenagers don't look so happy, do they? These are women from the island. He noted that all the men look like brothers and all the women look like sisters, even if they were not related. That's because their diet brought out the optimal expression of their genetics. And this beautiful lady is 90 years old. We do not know the average lifespan of these primitive people. And of course, that's one of the criticisms that we hear. Oh, but these people only lived to age 40. But there was not a lot of childhood death. These people knew how to have healthy babies. And there were plenty of elderly people. True, there were people who were killed through trauma. It was a dangerous life. But the elders tended to live apart. They had foods that were easy to gather and to a process were reserved for the elders. So there are special elder foods, and the elders played very important roles in the culture as teachers and wise men, wise women and wise men. So looking at the diet of the South Seas, we now have a very different type of diet. This is the tropics. They had plenty of plant foods in the diet, fruits and vegetables. One of the most important fruits in the diet was the coconut. The coconut is actually a fruit. It's not a nut. Very high fat fruit. They also had a starchy fruit, the taro root, which was prepared by fermentation. This is a theme we find worldwide, that the foods high in carbohydrates like grains and the taro root tended to be fermented. But nevertheless, the basis of the diet was animal foods. Here you see the octopus and the crab, and they ate the whole animal. They will eat the organ meats of the crab. They will take the shell and grind it up and add it to their food for calcium. They had pigs on the island, and the pigs were cooked in underground pits, and they ate the whole animal, including the fat and the organ meats and the head and the skin and everything. This young man is having a snack, which he did not get from a vending machine. He's eating a delicious fatty sea worm. Once again, the same pattern. Those who had been introduced to Western foods, usually by the missionaries, and Dr. Price was a devout Methodist. He taught Sunday school, went to church all his life, but he became very disillusioned with the missionary program because he recognized that it was the missionaries who were bringing in the foods, and they were the wedge that introduced these. And because people looked up to the missionaries, they thought, well, we want to eat like them also. And the first thing that happened was the rampant tooth decay causing a tremendous suffering. And then in the next generation, the altered facial structure, the narrowing of the face, the crowding of the teeth. And what else has happened? Those beautiful smiles have disappeared. And these two young people have an expression on their faces of someone who thinks he's been cheated. They have a chip on their shoulder. And they have been cheated. They may not be able to put it into words, but they've been cheated of their birthright of physical perfection. That's the birthright of every single human being born on this planet. And to make sure that everyone has that birthright is a partnership. It's a partnership with the Creator. The Creator provided the blueprint, and we have to have the wisdom to provide the right building materials. And I do believe that this sense of not being given what we deserve to have, which is an attractive, healthy body and a keen, clear mind, is the root of so much unhappiness and violence and addiction and depression and so forth among our young people, especially in this generation. These photos were taken in a tuberculosis ward in Hawaii. Every single child in this ward had dental deformities. Now, the dental deformities were not the cause of the tuberculosis, but the same conditions that prevented the optimal expression of their genetic potential made these children very susceptible to diseases like tuberculosis. Dr. Price studied the Aboriginal people in Australia. Those living in the bush were noted for their strength, agility, their stamina, their keen eyesight and hearing. These are Aboriginal women who have never been to the dentist, never used a toothbrush, but their teeth are so perfect, they look like false teeth. The diet of these people is fascinating. There's a long article about it on our website. They had both plant and animal foods, and we see the same things, the same themes, a tremendous emphasis on the fats. If they killed an animal that was too lean, they threw it away. And then they ate a lot of grains and legumes in this diet, and these were all prepared with great care, usually by soaking them in running water for about 2 weeks before they prepared them. And once again, the same pattern. Those who became modernized had tremendous tooth decay. Those who remained and stayed in their native lifestyle had good, strong teeth well into old age. They died with good teeth. And then the next generation, the altered facial structure, what Dr. Price called the underdevelopment of the middle third of the face, quite sunken in here, and then the crowded teeth and overbites. Dr. Price went to Africa. He went into the interior of Africa, into parts of Africa that had very few white men had been before. And here he could not get over what he found. He found seven tribes with 100 or more members in every tribe and not a single cavity, zero, zero cavities in over 700 people. Even those who filed their teeth as a custom did not get cavities. And he found zero dental deformities. Beautiful, broad facial structure among the Africans. Now, his African experience allowed him to compare different diets practiced by the same racial group, three different diets. The first diet was the diet of the herding people, like the Maasai. They kept cattle and goats, and their diet consisted of milk, meat, and blood. There were virtually no plant foods in this diet. It was a very high-fat diet. The warriors at their prime consumed about a gallon and a half of milk, usually raw fermented milk, every day, which gave them the equivalent of 3 sticks of butter fat a day, 3 sticks of butter a day. And yet they had no heart disease. The second group was the hunter-gatherer. They did not milk animals. They did not keep animals. They hunted and fished and collected plant foods. These people also had no cavities. They were very sturdy and strong. They had a sacred food, which was liver, which was so sacred they only touched it with their swords or their spear tips. But it was a mixed diet. Then the third group were the agriculturalists. They did not keep animals. They did not hunt. They grew corn, beans, and squash. They were not vegans, however, because a very important part of the diet was insects. It was only 10% animal food in this diet, but it was a very nutrient-dense animal food of insects. Now, these people, the agriculturalists, did have a certain amount of tooth decay, about 6%, and some of the older folks were toothless. They tended to be shorter and not as strong, not as robust as the other two groups. They were dominated by the other two groups, and they tended to be overweight as well. They were certainly healthier than his patients back in Cleveland, but they were not as healthy as the other two groups. Between the herders who had no plant foods in the diet and the hunter-gatherers who had a mixed diet, Dr. Price found that those with the mixed diet were actually stronger and had better proportions. And so his conclusion from the African experience was that the ideal diet avoids the extremes between too much animal food and too much plant food. So somewhere in the middle. And, you know, it could be more in this direction, more in this direction. But I think that's good news for us because it means that we don't have to have some kind of extreme diet where we're only eating steak or we're only eating, you know, rice. But it's a mixed diet that creates the best health. Here are, this is the Maasai, very, very tall. These are the herding people. But no matter which diet they started on, none of these groups was immune to the ravages of the displacing foods of Western commerce, causing the tremendous tooth decay and pain. And then in the next generation, just took one generation for this to happen, the narrowing of the face and the altered facial structure. This photograph perfectly illustrates the difference between a normal, this is normal facial structure, and what we would call a modern face, narrow face. You can see that there's a lot of strength in the bones of the face, the cheeks, the dental arch, whereas this face looks like it's not supporting itself but sort of hanging from the skull. And this is an adjustment that the body makes, a compromise that the body makes when the building materials are not sufficiently strong. We see here a dental cast. This is an adult primitive person, and this is an adult modernized person. So looking from the front, you see what you see here is beauty, strength, and order. And what you see here is chaos, a weakness, what Dr. Price called physical degeneration. And we know from animal studies that if this type of diet that causes this continues for two or three generations, you end up with no more reproduction, no more humans or no more animals. So the situation really is very serious. This is why we're so passionate about what we're doing. We're on the precipice here. We're at the 11th hour. We're on our third generation of this type of diet. And what are we seeing? Rampant infertility, heartbreaking infertility, and more health problems in our children. Many children not reaching adulthood. I've included some architectural diagrams because the principle of building a strong wide arch in architecture is the same as the principle of building a strong wide arch in the body. It's strong building materials. A study that was done on cats by Dr. Pottinger, he looked at cats over many generations, and he found that if he gave cats a deficient diet, and the diet for each species is different. When he gave them a diet that was deficient for cats, over several generations, they developed a lot of behavior problems, health problems. They developed digestive problems. And then by the fourth generation, there were no more cats. They stopped reproducing. So this is what the typical dentist sees in his practice today. All of these deformities, and the dentist might say it's due to thumb sucking, or it's because you didn't breastfeed, or because heredity. But it's none of these. It's really what causes this is poor nutrition leading up to pregnancy and in the womb. And you can tell when a baby's born what kind of facial structure he has and whether that baby will be prone to dental deformities. The first bone that is affected by poor nutrition in the body is this bone. It is the maxilla, or upper jawbone, the bone that forms the middle third of the face. Almost every other bone in the body touches on the in the skull, touches on the maxilla. The next bone that is affected is the mandible, or the lower jawbone. And here we see the skull from the back. Here's the maxilla. And this beautiful bone is called the sphenoid. It looks like a butterfly. And you can just imagine, in order for that bone to be broad and to, you know, broad and wide, it has to be strong. Otherwise, the body will build it more narrow. And by the way, there are little cavities up here in the skull where these important organs sit like the hypothalamus. little depressions in the bones. So if the skull is narrow, there won't be as much space for these important glands. So I'm going to finish this rather lengthy introduction with a few pictures of my own. This is an American woman who was born in the southern United States in the 1920s. And she has beautiful facial structure, naturally straight teeth. The kind of face that we associate with the old-fashioned American beauty. And she did not have to eat cod's head stuffed with chopped cod's liver or sea worms or anything yucky to get this bone structure. She grew up on foods that we can all embrace, starting with whole raw milk. The family lived next to a Jersey dairy farm, and they had plenty of raw milk, lots of cream and butter in the diet. No one told them it was bad for them. A lot of seafood in the diet. They lived on the water, and they had crab and fish. And fish eggs were an important food in the diet. The shad roe they ate every spring. Beef, pork, chicken, and lamb, a lot of chicken broth, fruits and vegetables. This was a time the family didn't have a lot of money, so they weren't spending their money on sweets and candies and so forth. So, this is a diet that we can all embrace. And that's one of our messages, that the diet that's nutritious can also be delicious. We don't want you to think there's a big yuck factor in a healthy diet. This gentleman grew up on a farm in eastern Texas. If you look at the space between the eye and the outside of the head on both sides, this is not a three-quarter view. This is a front view. He has beautiful facial structure. He was an orphan. He was raised on his grandfather's farm, pretty much neglected. He said the goats and the mules were my mother's, and he actually suckled milk directly from these animals. He said if he found a crawdad in the stream, he had to eat it raw right there, otherwise someone would take it from him. He said, I got the leavings. I was not allowed to eat at the table, and so the livers and the chicken heads and the gizzards and the feet is what I grew up on. So the most nutrient-dense parts of the animals. And this gentleman is still going strong in his 90s. After a very colorful life, for many years, he made his living as a card sharp and a bootlegger. He had a very keen mind. He could take a deck of cards and mark them up, surreptitiously. And within 10 minutes, he said he knew what every card in the deck was from the back of the card. This is Agnes MacPhail. She's a Canadian. She's a great reformer and champion of women's rights. Now, the Gaelic face genetically is more narrow than, say, the Alpine face or the African face, but that you can still see the wonderful bone structure here. And she grew up on a dairy farm. I don't know if any of you recognize this group, Freddie Lyman and the Teenagers. They're very popular in the 50s, and what strikes me about this photograph is their wonderful dental development. They did not have their teeth straightened. They could not have afforded that. Almost certainly they grew up in an environment where they had access to raw milk and lots of organ meats. And the African Americans tended to eat least expensive cuts of meat. What I want to say here is you can't go into a high school today in the United States and find five young people with naturally straight teeth like this if they're born in the United States. This kind of dental structure, which was normal even in the 50s, has disappeared. The temptations a generation later may have had their teeth straightened and whitened, but can you see this change in facial structure? It's this underdevelopment of the middle third of the face. And we know that if you continue this kind of diet for another generation or two, you have no more reproduction. I love this photograph from 1910. Now, these are athletes. One of them has a narrow face, so that he's the exception. Everyone else has beautiful facial development. Look at the high cheekbones. This is a European American. This is a Native American. The Native Americans were eating buffalo guts and foods that we don't like, you know. But European Americans have equally good bone structure, and they were eating raw milk, meats, organ meats, a lot of organ meats in those days. Now, today, if you take a photograph like this, even a photograph of athletes, it's the reverse. You may have two or three with excellent bone structure, usually not born in the United States, born in the Caribbean or someplace like that, and all the rest have compromised or narrowed facial structure. Here's a famous person. Elvis was very handsome, but he had a narrow face compared to his parents. Look at their facial structure. So the diet that we had in this country up to the Second World War, in general, supported good physical development. Here we have some Latin American children. Probably from a very poor village. We would say that these children were deprived. And yet they have the greatest gift that any human being can have, and that is normal physical development. They probably grew up on kind of a plant-based diet, rice and beans, but certainly they had access to raw milk, especially goat milk. If they did eat animal foods, it was usually the organ meats, and they probably had access to seafood as well. The modern westernized child tends to have a very narrow face. Most of them need braces to straighten their teeth. They are plagued with allergies and asthma. How many of you work in schools today? What are you seeing? Yeah, lots of overdevelopment, overweight, right? Lots of asthma, learning disabilities, behavior problems. We have an epidemic on our hands, and it's the children who are paying the price. The narrow face has become so commonplace that we think of this as normal. These are fashion models. Now, if this is where you ended up, and it's where I ended up, I needed braces. I was very unhealthy growing up. It doesn't mean it's hopeless. You can't change your facial structure, but you can definitely regain your health using the same dietary principles. So I don't want you to feel that there's nothing that can be done. The good news is that the trend towards the narrowing of the face and the physical degeneration can be reversed. And this beautiful woman was born to a mother who had a narrow face, who had a lot of health problems. And when she was a teenager, her family moved to a place where she was near a dairy. And she had access to raw Guernsey milk. And she also they had a little bit more money. And she said she often went out with her friends for lunch, and she couldn't afford the most expensive things on the menu. So she ended up ordering liver about three times a week. So she ate a lot of liver as a teenager. And then gave birth to this beautiful girl with naturally straight teeth, who very healthy, very intelligent, very healthy. And my story is similar. When I was a young woman, I went to France to learn to speak French. I went to school in France. And when I was in France, I discovered a food I had never eaten before. And that food is called pâté. And when I had my first bite of pâté, it was like my body giving a sigh of relief. I said, what is this food? It is so delicious. And I made a pig of myself in Europe. I ate pâté morning, noon, and night. I had it for breakfast. And I can't eat that much pâté now. But at that time, I was very depleted. And I really gorged myself on this nutrient-dense food. I had never eaten liver in my life till I went to Europe. And after that, I made a point of always having some as often as I could because I loved it so much. And that was a very fortuitous thing because my first daughter, who was born long before I was introduced to all this, my first child, had naturally straight teeth and none of the health problems that I suffered from as a child. So it's very reversible. And here are some of our beautiful Weston Price babies. Mothers who have followed our dietary guidelines and our very nutrient-dense diet while they're pregnant. And these babies have broad faces. They are absolutely delightful children. They don't cry very much. They are cheerful. They meet their milestones. There's no greater gift than any family can have. And these are the kind of children that are the hope of the future. And fortunately, a lot of people are listening to what we have to say. I'm pleased to see many young women in this audience because, you know, our future is actually in your hands, in the hands of the young women. Without you listening and taking the effort to eat properly and feed your children properly, we're sunk. We're hopeless. We have no future without you. And the role of the rest of us, the grandmothers, the spouses, partners, aunts and uncles, sisters and brothers, is to support these young women to make it easy and for them to eat properly. So as Dr. Price said, natural beauty, individual beauty is a matter of both design of the face and regularity and perfection of the teeth. Nature always builds harmoniously if conditions are sufficiently favorable, regardless of race, color, or location. He was an amazing man because in his day, one of the reasons given for the narrowing of the face was race mixing. It's a very racist explanation. And Dr. Price was very careful to point out that he had seen physical degeneration in people whose parents were of the same race, and beautiful physical structure in parents, in children whose parents were of different races, but who followed the native diets. So let's just, we've gone 1 hour. This is not a bathroom break, but it's a stretch break. Let's just stand up and have a little stretch. Thank you. No. Maybe it's a good idea, yeah. But I haven't been bothered by it, but thank you for this.
You're welcome. Oh, and Linda said it's on her.
Oh, okay.
So I have your
phone. Okay.
Yeah. I think I must have eaten a lot of it. Like,
yeah.
But when I started following Western Price again, and I started following about 2 years ago, I got a lot of doubt.
Really?
My fingers wouldn't be all locked up every morning.
Were you taking the cod liver oil?
I was taking everything. I was doing a lot of it. And I think I'm more tortured than acid.
Could be.
I'm just wondering.
Maybe not enough plant foods, yeah.
Don't you hear a lot of that?
I've never heard that before from one of our people. Well, actually, no. There's an article on our website on gout, and the studies show that it's from too much carbohydrates. So I'm very surprised. Yeah, because they had sugar.
Yeah, drinks.
Yeah, yeah. Well, read the article on gout on our website.
Okay.
Yeah, but I've never heard that before. So that's interesting. Yes. When the milk, around about the Second World War. Yeah. Where did you live? Where did you live? Well, it may have been raw. Yeah. Let's wait. I'm gonna have people sit down. All right. If you could take your seats. Oh, isn't she gorgeous? Yeah. All right. One thing we notice, and we always warn the hotels where we have our conferences, our groups are very talkative. All right, so by now you're probably completely confused, right? I said I was going to answer the question, what is a healthy diet? And as we've seen, there were many different diets. A lot of people read Dr. Price's book and kind of throw up their hands and say, well, there's no such thing as a healthy diet. Some of these diets had almost no plant foods. Some had very few animal foods. Some had a lot of cooked foods, some had mostly a lot of raw food, some had dairy foods and some didn't, some had grains and some didn't. How are we going to make sense of this? Well, Dr. Price did address this at the very end of his book, chapter 22, and with some underlying characteristics. He came up with three, and then we have added to these. So what we're going to do now is look at the underlying characteristics of healthy diets. What are the principles? And then once you understand the principles, you can eat a diet that conforms to your lifestyle, to how much time you have, to how much you can afford, to what's available to you, and most importantly, to what your children will actually eat. Because it's very important to like these foods and for them to taste good to you. So what we're going to do now is look at 11 characteristics of healthy traditional diets. That will take us to the middle of the afternoon. And then we will get practical, we'll roll up our sleeves and talk about 11 ways you can change your diet for the better. So that's the outline of what we're going to do. So number one, there were no refined or denatured foods in these healthy traditional diets. And the components of the diet that were refined in Dr. Price's day make a fairly short list. White sugar, white flour, vegetable oils just coming into the diet, canned foods, and condensed milk. The list is quite a bit longer today. Not only do we have refined sugar, we have high fructose corn syrup, which, as we will see later on this afternoon, is actually worse than white sugar, and the artificial sweeteners. White flour, that is the basis of the Western diet. White flour. You walk through an airport and look at all the bread and buns and things that are being sold. Pasteurized milk and skim and low-fat milk are not whole foods. They are foods in which valuable components have been removed or destroyed. Hydrogenated fats and refined vegetable oils are not have not been in the human diet until very recently, and we will learn about these and why they are so dangerous. And finally, I'm concerned about the protein powders. This is a refined food, and it carries a very special danger that we will learn about. And finally, all the additives in the food, and these additives are additive in their effects. If, as a culture, we decided that we needed maybe two or three additives to use for preserving foods or whatever, and our diet was otherwise healthy, it'd probably be okay. But in animal studies, they find that if they give several additives at the, you know, what's considered the safe dose, they are additive in their effects and you end up with dead animals. So that's what we're seeing in our food. So one of Dr. Price's most famous sayings was, life in its fullness is Mother Nature obeyed. And once again, Dr. Price was so different from the scientists of his day. And even of our day, the scientists of today believes that what's here in nature got here by chance and was, you know, very long evolution, and there might be mistakes out there, and they're going to fix them. The scientists are going to fix those mistakes, like this mistake that milk has fat in it. They're going to fix that. Okay. This mistake that pests can eat crops. So they're going to genetically engineer those crops and fix it. That's a mistake. I've actually heard people say, oh, we've learned to outsmart Mother Nature. And you know what? Mother Nature bats last. And Mother Nature always gets her revenge. And so this is why, and Dr. Price understood this. We live embedded in nature. There's a wisdom in nature that we don't fully understand. But in order to live a full life, we have to honor and respect that wisdom. And factory foods are not Mother Nature's foods. And if you're eating these foods, you are not going to live your life to the full extent. You may not have the best of health. You may have health problems in your children. You may not be able to accomplish what you said you were going to accomplish before you came into embodiment. And these are all factory foods that we just need to avoid for various reasons. Okay, number two, the second underlying characteristic was that every diet contained animal products. This was Dr. Price's greatest disappointment. He had hoped to find a culture where they were only eating plant foods, and he had to admit after traveling all over the world that he didn't find a culture like that. And that, in fact, these people went to considerable danger and risk to obtain animal foods. In his opinion, the most important animal foods were fish and shellfish, because the people who had fish and shellfish in their diets had the best bone structure and the thickest skulls. He not only looked at living people, he took, he always asked to see the skulls of the dead, and he took calipers with him and measured the thickness of the skull. And the people with fish and shellfish in their diet had the thickest skulls, and it's a good thing. It's good to have a thick skull. And they were not just eating the, you know, skinless fillets. They ate the organs, the oil, the bones, the head, and shellfish. And so not just, you know, fillet of sole or salmon steak or whatever. Many cultures consume birds, and they were not eating the skinless chicken breast. They valued the organs, especially the liver of the bird, the fat, and the skin. And the bones. Often the bones were crushed and added to other foods. Many cultures consumed red meat, domesticated animals, beef, goat, sheep, and then game, always with the organ meats and the fat preferred, not the lean meat. Many cultures had milk and milk products. All throughout Europe, Mongolia, Northern Africa, these diets contain a lot of milk products. Eggs in many cultures, and some cultures consumed reptiles or insects, which is not one of our choices. These we find repulsive, but we have many other choices of animal foods. There are certain nutrients that we need that are found only in animal products, starting with vitamins A and D found in the fats and organ meats, and we will talk about these in more detail in a moment. Cholesterol is a nutrient for the fetus and for growing children. This has to be supplied in the diet for the optimal development of the brain, which is very high in cholesterol, and the second brain. What's the second brain? The gut, the digestive tract. And the cells lining the digestive tract are particularly rich in cholesterol, and they can take cholesterol right from the food we've eaten and incorporate it into those cells. So we really do need cholesterol in the diets of our pregnant women and growing children. And one of the crimes of modern culture is that we're teaching these women to avoid cholesterol and putting children on low-fat diets. B12, very important, found only in animal foods, and certain types of fats. Arachidonic acid, and especially these two, EPA and DHA, especially the DHA, these are critical for many functions in the body, brain function, healthy skin, healthy gut, and they are found almost exclusively in animal foods. Now, there are many nutrients that we find in both plant foods and animal foods, but they're much more readily absorbed from the plant foods, and we start with calcium. There's lots of calcium in plant foods, but it's in a form that's bound up, that's chelated, and your body actually has to work to get the calcium out of plant foods. It has to expend a lot of energy on enzymes and vitamins to extract that calcium. In traditional cultures, there really were only two sources of calcium, either dairy foods, raw dairy foods, or bones. And think of the Asian people who don't consume dairy foods. It is traditional to have a bone broth with every meal. The Native Americans, surprisingly enough, they didn't have milk products. They used bone broth, and they did not drink water. They thought water was unhealthy. When they were thirsty, they drank bone broth. B6, magnesium, iron, zinc, and copper, once again, very important vitamins and minerals that are much more available from the animal foods. One of the easiest ways to become deficient in zinc is to eat a vegan diet. It's very hard to get zinc from plant foods. B12 is a very important vitamin. We associate B12 deficiency with anemia, but the early signs of B12 deficiency are neurological, including fatigue, tingling in the hands and feet, sleep disorders, and a tendency to irrational anger. Someone who is flying off the handle all the time. This is a person who may be deficient in B12. People are very mellow. Get along, go with the flow. These tend to be people who have good B12 status. More serious psychiatric disorders associated with B12 deficiency include depression, obsessive compulsive behavior, manic depression, and dementia. 95% of the people in our mental institutions are very deficient in B12. And finally, we associate it with chronic diseases like multiple sclerosis, anemia, cancer, and heart disease. B12 is found only in animal products. Now, there are claims that you can get B12 from blue-green algae or fermented soy food. And what you see on testing these foods is something that looks like B12, but it actually blocks the uptake of the true B12. So you can become actually more deficient in B12 by eating these foods. The absorption of B12 is very difficult. It has to be bound to a protein. And that protein is called the intrinsic factor. It's secreted by the same cells in the stomach that secrete hydrochloric acid. So if you're deficient in hydrochloric acid, you may end up being deficient in B12. Those most likely to be deficient are vegetarians and the elderly. For vegetarians who are getting their B12 from dairy products, you have to understand that the usable B12 is destroyed by pasteurization. What pasteurization destroys is a carrier protein for the B12. Now, I do have to ask now, do we have any vegetarians or vegans in our group here? Okay, that's fine. That's fine. I'm not going to stand here and say you have to eat red meat. You have to eat a big steak every day. Our diet is not about eating lots and lots of meat. We'll do questions at the end. You're having a hard time hearing? Did you find the AV person? If I stand like that, is that better? Is that better? Okay. So we're not here to tell you you have to eat red meat, that you have to eat a big steak every day. This beautiful woman comes from a tribe whose diet was just fermented goat milk and insects. So to be a healthy vegetarian, you just eat good raw dairy and insects, right? Or eggs. Eggs have a lot of the same nutrition as insects. And I have met, I met a man once whose ancestry was Swiss. He had a farm. He had beautiful teeth. He said he had 5 children, all with beautiful teeth, and they only ate dairy foods and eggs. But they were raw, grass-fed dairy foods and his pastured eggs. So for some people, it is possible to be healthy on a lacto-ovo-vegetarian diet. I say some people because there's other people who absolutely do need meat, fish, and organ meats. And particularly if your ancestors were seacoast people like the Irish or a Native American ancestry who had a lot of these foods in the diet, these people are lacking certain enzymes and definitely need to have the animal foods in the diet. My ancestors were Irish and Native American, so I definitely need meat in my diet. And do not think that if you are avoiding animal foods that you are not dependent on the products of slaughtered animals. This is some beef industry propaganda here. Not only the steak on our plate, but many other components come from animal products. Waxes, crayons, pharmaceuticals, household products, cosmetics. They use animal byproducts in modern building materials, special types of glues, in hydraulic brake fluid for airplanes. There's a membrane in the telephone that vibrates that's made with beef gelatin. So do not think that you can take the moral high ground and say that you know you're a better person because you're not dependent on animals, because we're all dependent on animals. And we were more so in the past. You know, we could not have arrived where we are today without the leather from animals, the furs from animals to keep us warm, the bones from animals used for tools. So I actually went to a lecture the other day by a long-term vegan who looked like death warmed over, I have to say. But he basically said this is the moral way to live, and I'm more moral than you are because I don't eat meat, and I do bristle at that. And it's important to know the origins of the modern vegetarian dietary movement. The American Vegetarian Society was founded by Sylvester Graham. who advocated a whole grain vegetarian diet to promote chastity and curb lust. It was for moral reasons that he promoted this diet. This man taught that mothers should never hug their little boys because it might elicit sexual feelings. Boys should sleep on hard beds. And he had extremely violent treatment for little girls who showed any sexual feelings. So it works. This diet does depress libido for sure. And then John Harvey Kellogg was the other very famous person who promoted this kind of diet. He promoted a high-fiber vegetarian diet to combat the twin evils of constipation and natural urges. He preached against sexual activity even in marriage. He was fixated on the bowels. This is where we got the notion that you should have a bowel movement two or three times a day, which is not correct. So point I'm trying to make here is these men were nutcases. They were really horrible people, probably with a lot of serious hang-ups of their own. And we've gone through the sexual revolution. You know, we've come to realize that if you suppress natural urges, they reemerge in pathological ways or criminal ways. So we've thrown all that off, but the diet that they advocated is still with us, enshrined as national policy in the dietary guidelines. So, and what we're doing now to our children, we're suppressing their natural urges for fat, for rich foods. And what do we end up with? Pathologies, eating disorders. So we've got quite a long ways to go. All right, this is the key slide of the whole day. This and the next couple of slides. This was Dr. Price's key finding and the part that most people miss when they're talking about Weston Price. He took these foods home to his laboratory and analyzed them for nutrient content and was amazed at how rich in nutrients, how nutrient dense these diets were. Very high in minerals, very high in calcium, magnesium, iodine, copper, iron, all of the key minerals. But even more surprising was the very high levels of what he called fat-soluble vitamins in the traditional diet. There were 10 times more of these fat-soluble vitamins in the primitive diet compared to the American diet of his day. So we're going to talk now in some detail about these fat-soluble vitamins. There were three of them. We're going to start with A and D. Very high levels of A and D in these diets. So where do we get vitamins A and D? Well, we get them from certain types of seafood. We get them from fish eggs, fish livers, and fish liver oil, like cod liver oil. Fish heads, which we see in Asian diets, in the Gaelic diet, extremely high in vitamin A in the fish heads. Shellfish, rich sources of vitamin D, same with oily fish, and the sea mammals, like the seals and the whales and so forth that they ate. And land animals, insects, which are not part of our diet, butter and cream, egg yolks, liver and organ meats, and animal fats, if these animals are outside eating green grass in the sunlight. If the animals are in the sunlight, these foods will be a good source of vitamin D. If they're eating green grass, they'll be a good source of vitamin A. Now, what do you notice about these lists of foods? These are all the high-fat, high-cholesterol foods that we're being told not to eat. These are the demonized foods. People are afraid of these foods. Oh, we can't eat butter and cream. It's full of saturated fats. And egg yolks, loaded with cholesterol. Oh, if you eat liver, you're going to poison yourself with vitamin A. And organ meats, loaded with cholesterol. And whatever you do, don't eat any animal fat. Use the vegetable oils instead. And the latest victim of this smear campaign is the seafoods, which are considered now dangerous because of their mercury content. And I'm going to come back to this subject of mercury. We actually, in traditional diets, have some very strong protection against mercury. And there's always been mercury in seafood, mercury in the oceans. So basically what I'm saying is the basis of a healthy diet is including as many of these products as possible in your diet. Some you may not like, some may be unavailable. nevertheless, to include as many as possible. So that's a very different message than the one you're hearing everywhere else. Dr. Price referred to the fat-soluble vitamins as fat-soluble activators because they are the catalysts for using minerals in the food. He said it is possible to starve for minerals that are abundant in the foods eaten because they cannot be utilized without an adequate quantity of the fat-soluble activators. So you can be eating organic food and mineral drinks and, you know, a lot of emphasis on high mineral foods, but unless you have these fat-soluble activators, these minerals are going to waste. If you think of the body as a house or a temple, the bricks are the minerals and the mortar is the fat-soluble activators, A and D, and you need both of them for a strong body. Now, there are a lot of myths out there about vitamins A and D, and the first myth is that vitamin A is found in leafy green vegetables and yellow and orange fruits. And I have a special corner of hell in my library for all of the books that say vitamin A is very important, eat your leafy green vegetables. What's in these plant foods is not vitamin A, it is the precursors called carotenes. And if you go to a biochemistry textbook or the Merck manual, you will read there's no vitamin A in plant foods. It's not the true vitamin A, it's the precursors. This is beta carotene. It is the most active of these precursors. And what happens in the intestinal tract of animals and a little bit in humans, we can do this to a certain extent, is that it is split here and oxygen is added and you get the true vitamin A. This is a true vitamin A. It's a very difficult process because of this addition of oxygen. It requires a lot of enzymes to take place. And it takes, even in people who can do this, it takes anywhere from 12 to 48 of these molecules to produce one molecule of vitamin A. There was a recent study from England that showed that 47% of all women are completely unable to make this conversion. So a lot of people actually can't do it. In order to make this conversion, you first of all need fats in the diet because the conversion takes place in the presence of bile. And you don't secrete bile unless you eat fats. So there is a reason that we put cream in our soup or butter on our carrots. Because you need that fat to actually use those carotenes, to make vitamin A of those carotenes. Plus, the foods taste so much better with the cream or butter. So there's, you know, our taste is, our taste buds are telling us something. A lot of enzymes are involved. Thyroid hormone is involved, and so is vitamin E. Now, one thing we do know is that babies and children cannot make this conversion. They cannot store vitamin A very well. They just don't have everything online to do this. And this is why babies need to start out on animal foods rich in vitamin A. It's why children don't like vegetables very much. I have mothers calling me so worried, oh, my baby doesn't like vegetables. Well, don't worry about it. Babies can't do a lot with vegetables. And they need more vitamin A than adults do because they're growing and because they can't make it. The other large group that has this problem is diabetics. They very often lack enzymes to convert carotenes into vitamin A. And when you think about the problems that diabetics have, such as healing, retina problems, and kidney problems, these are all problems of vitamin A deficiency. And I'm not saying that vitamin A can cure diabetes, but vitamin A can support the diabetic and prevent all of these terrible side effects that they sometimes have. Are we okay in the back? No. We're trying to get AV to make it louder. I do apologize. If you have poor thyroid function, poor liver function, poor, you know, leaky gut, a lot of additives in your diet, you can't make this conversion. Pesticides and toxins. The reason pesticides are toxic is because they interfere with vitamin A pathways. That's why they're toxic. And so if, I know none of you use pesticides, but let's say you live next to a farm that used pesticides, you live in an apartment building where they've sprayed, or you have to work in a hairdresser, a print shop, a cleaner's, you're exposed to chemicals all day long. you need more vitamin A, because the way those chemicals harm you is through these vitamin A pathways. And just eating a lot of carotene, a lot of leafy greens, a lot of carrots, that shuts down this whole conversion mechanism. So even under optimal conditions, plant sources of carotenes cannot supply sufficient vitamin A for optimal health. And vitamin A is critical. It is needed for mineral metabolism, as we said. You need it to absorb calcium. You also need vitamin A to use protein. What happens when we eat lean meat or consume skim milk or eat egg whites without the yolks or take a protein powder? The body says, protein. I need vitamin A to use this protein, and it goes to the liver to get the vitamin A. And the quickest way to deplete your body of vitamin A is to eat a high-protein, low-fat diet, which is what's being promoted these days. And I can't tell you how many people we've talked to who've gotten in trouble using protein powders. Burnout, autoimmune disease, even running into cancer. Vitamin A is critical for proper growth and the prevention of birth defects. Now, the latest area of scientific research is stem cell research. And it's a fascinating area of research. Stem cells are undifferentiated cells. And the fetus starts out as stem cells, and then it gets a signal to form a heart cell or a lung cell or, you know, a liver cell. You know, these organs don't replenish themselves by dividing. They get new cells from stem cells, both in the growing child and in the adult. Adults have stem cells all over their bodies. What is it that tells the stem cell to become a heart cell, or a liver cell, or a lung cell? It's vitamin A. Vitamin A is the concert master of the growing fetus, and it's what keeps us cancer-free and allows the right kind of cell division in the body. So this is why you need to build up your vitamin A stores before you get pregnant, because the heart's the first organ to form. By the time you know you're pregnant, that heart has already formed. And if you didn't have enough vitamin A to form the heart properly, you may have a miscarriage, or you may have a baby with a problem in the heart, which is becoming very, very common these days. The entire endocrine system is dependent on vitamin A. The thyroid gland, you need vitamin A to make thyroid hormones. You need vitamin A to make immune hormones, T cells. All the stress hormones and sex hormones require vitamin A. Vitamin A is needed for brain function, planning, and task completion. The ability to start a task, a project, and complete it is dependent on vitamin A. Interesting. And vitamin A is needed for healthy eyes, skin, and bones. We think of bones, vitamin D for bones, but you need vitamin A for healthy bones. This is a chart showing all of the hormones made out of cholesterol. If I stand here, is that louder? It's okay now? All of the, that is louder. All of the sex hormones are made out of cholesterol, progesterone, estrogen, testosterone. And then over here, we have the adrenal cortex hormones, which regulate blood sugar, blood pressure, mineral metabolism. They help us deal with stress. They help us heal, help with inflammation. They're all made of cholesterol, and they all require vitamin A. Every arrow here is an enzymatic conversion that requires vitamin A. We have had dramatic cures of people who have hormonal problems, very long and debilitating menstrual periods, endometriosis, fibroid tumors, by getting them on very high doses of cod liver oil. So the body can actually has the signals that it needs to make these hormones. Same with stress, same with healing, and vitamin A is really critical. The trans fats, which we'll talk about this afternoon, inhibit all of these conversions. So by going from animal fats that have vitamin A in them to the trans fats, we've created this sort of double jeopardy. And no wonder everyone needs prednisone today to heal, because that's the artificial cortisol that the bodies can't make anymore. This was an interesting study done in Texas in the 1940s. They took normal pigs, mated them, and when the sows were pregnant, they removed vitamin A from the diet, and all the piglets were born blind with a petrified optic nerve. They took the blind piglets and mated them. A few of the sows were able to get pregnant. They returned vitamin A to the diet of the pregnant sows, and then all the babies were born with normal sight, even though the parents were blind. So here is something we consider a genetic defect, being born blind, that's turned on and off with vitamin A. Now, vitamin A stores are rapidly depleted by stress. Now, nobody here is ever under any stress, though, right? We don't have to worry about that one. When you have good vitamin A stores, stress is actually exhilarating. You'd be bored without stress. But if you are lacking in vitamin A, every little thing is stressful, because you can't make stress hormones when you're lacking vitamin A. This is why people who go through very stressful situations, like the death of a loved one or a divorce or a financial hardship, tend to have more tendency to diseases like cancer and heart disease, because the stress depletes them of vitamin A. Too much protein, we talked about that. Cold weather is very depleting. In Scandinavia, they kept the little box outside the door with the cod liver oil in it, and they took the cod liver oil when they went outside in the cold. Fever and illness, very depleting of vitamin A, and it's very important for children to have fevers. One of the theories about why we have so much cancer today is we're not allowing children to have fevers. Fevers really kickstart the immune system. They're very important. But when a child has a fever, you want to make sure you give them some egg yolks, some cod liver oil, a little liver pate or something, so they keep their vitamin A stores high, so the fever doesn't deplete them. Because if you get too depleted in a fever, you may end up blind or with a seizure. Physical exertion depletes vitamin A, and exposure to toxins, so pesticides, chemicals, these are very depleting of vitamin A. That's why they're toxic. We have numerous papers showing that vitamin A protects against dioxins. And this is why cod liver oil is so important if you are being exposed to these kinds of chemicals. Fish eaters in Japan, there's a lot of dioxins in commercial fish, do not have high levels of dioxins in the blood, meaning that there must be protective factors in their diet, and that's almost certainly vitamin A. But the key point here is that dioxins have always been in our environment. What's the number one source of dioxins? Smoke. Think of our Gaelic people living in those smoke-filled cottages. They were exposed to dioxins every day. So the body must have a mechanism to deal with dioxins. This is not something new to human beings. In fact, we probably have far less exposure than we used to, because everyone was exposed to smoke. And so the body's mechanism for dealing with dioxins is vitamin A. Doesn't mean you should deliberately expose yourself to dioxins, but in any of these situations with environmental poisons, it's always a balance between avoiding overexposure and making sure you're protected nutritionally. Okay, moving on to vitamin D. There's a lot of myths about vitamin D, and the first one is that to get adequate vitamin D, all you need to do is go outside for 10 minutes every day, expose your hands and face, and you'll get all the vitamin D you need. And I was actually listening to the USDA webinars on the dietary guidelines, and there was a fire drill, and they had to go out and stand outside, and this was, March sometime, and they were all laughing about how they got their vitamin D by standing outside, and they should know better. Because we know now that we only get vitamin D when the sunlight's directly overhead, and in this part of the world, that occurs in July and August at midday. And if you go out and sunbathe in July and August at midday, you'll make a lot of vitamin D, but that's not very practical for most of us. And in any event, most of the year, we have to get our vitamin D from food. Even in the tropics, where people had overhead sunlight, they still got most of their vitamin D from food. And that brings us to the second vitamin D myth, that you can't get vitamin D from food. The people selling vitamin D supplements are telling us you can't get vitamin D from food. But you can get vitamin D from food. There's a lot of foods that contain vitamin D. The fish liver oils, fish eggs. We tested caviar and found 17,000 international units of vitamin D in one tablespoon of caviar. That's why caviar makes you feel so good. Shellfish are an excellent source, insects. Butterfat and egg yolks from animals in sunlight, organ meats, the fat of birds and pigs, and blood is a very good source of vitamin D. And many cultures use blood in their food, in their sausage, and their various dishes that they make. Vitamin D, like vitamin A, has many roles in the body. We associate with healthy bones, but it's necessary for proper growth. Mineral metabolism, not just healthy bones, but healthy muscles. If you have good vitamin D status, plenty of vitamin D in your diet, you don't have to work out to have a good muscle tone. It just happens naturally. Reproduction, healthy skin, you need vitamin D for insulin production. There was a very interesting study carried out in Scandinavia where they put one group of babies on cod liver oil for the first year of life, and another group of babies did not get cod liver oil. There was no other difference. There was no dietary guidelines. The diets were just the same. And then they followed these children into adulthood, and the children who got cod liver oil the first year of life, there were no cases of diabetes going into adulthood, zero. Those who had not had the cod liver oil developed diabetes at the normal rate of the population. The immune system and the nervous system depend on vitamin D, cell function, feel-good chemicals. This is a fascinating new area of research. We've learned that inside our bodies, we make what are called endorphins. These are feel-good chemicals that are identical to the drugs. We make cannabinoids that are identical to what's in marijuana. We make opiates that are identical to what's in opium. But we make them in just the right amounts, and we have receptors for these chemicals. And it's vitamin D that's needed for the production and the receptors for these chemicals. So vitamin D is really critical for just feeling good, for preventing depression. And vitamin D is associated with longevity. People with good vitamin D status tend to live a long time. We warn people about the synthetic vitamin D2. It's made from vegetarian sources, and it can have the opposite effect to the animal source, D3, causing softening of the hard tissues and hardening of the soft tissues. And this is what's the D2 is what's used in these artificial beverages based on soy, oats, rice, and almond. This is one reason to avoid these things. Well, what about toxicity? We hear a lot about these vitamins being toxic. In fact, I got a call the other day. It was one of our board members who's had a doctor tell her he's seeing a lot of people who've been taking huge amounts of vitamin D, and this is vitamin D3, the supposedly good type, seeing a lot of inflammation. People taking D3 all by itself. And then we know from certain studies carried out in Scandinavia that if you have a lot of vitamin A without the vitamin D, you get osteoporosis. So what we found, we did a huge literature search on this, and what we found is that these vitamins need to be taken together. They need to be, they're synergistic. If you have too much vitamin D, you get symptoms of vitamin A toxicity or deficiency. If you have too much vitamin A, you get symptoms of vitamin D deficiency. So you need to take these together. What we found is that if you have adequate vitamin D, I'm about to sneeze. Don't want to sneeze into the microphone. If you have adequate vitamin D, about 1,000 units a day, vitamin A is not toxic, even in the millions of units. And the ideal ratio, there's a lot of work going on now about the ideal ratio of A to D. And it should be at least 10, 1 to 10. In other words, for every 10 A, you should have 1 of D. And now they're even thinking it maybe should be 5 to 1, 5 A to 1 D. But what you don't want is to, for example, to take cod liver oil that has lots of vitamin A and almost no vitamin D. Or to eat a lot of liver full of vitamin A without having foods that are rich in vitamin D as well. These are modern Africans, beautiful bone structure. I'm from Washington, D.C. We have a lot of Africans come from Africa. You can always tell when they're born in Africa because they have such beautiful teeth, beautiful bone structure. And I like to ask them what they ate when they were growing up. You know, what they usually say, oh, my mother made beautiful peanut soup, or we ate fufu, which is fermented cassava. I said, no, what kind of animal foods did you eat? Well, we didn't have much meat. We were really poor. We ate frogs and we ate insects. Shrimp paste is a typical African food. It's sort of it's a condiment, sort of like ketchup. It's made from dried shrimp. This food is found throughout Africa and Asia, and it's like a vitamin D pill. It's extremely rich in vitamin D. Shrimp are very high in vitamin D. And this is palm oil, unrefined palm oil consumed throughout Africa. Now, these are carotenes that you see, but they're in an oil, so they would be absorbed fairly efficiently. They would be able to make a certain amount of vitamin A from the palm oil. And here are some other traditional foods of Africa. These are little dried fish with the heads and everything, very rich in vitamin A, and dried caterpillars, rich in A and D. And in many African cultures, these are the only animal foods they have. So these are low protein diets, but the protein foods they are eating are very high in A and D. And so that protein is adequate for them. But we don't like these foods. You know, you just can't do this in the Western diet. We find these foods quite repulsive. We don't like the taste of these foods. So we have to get our activators in a different way. And in the West, we traditionally got them from grass-fed dairy products, butter and cream, cheese, grass-fed, pasture-fed eggs. Up until the Second World War, almost every child in this country got cod liver oil. We recognized the need for extra A and D. And we ate organ meats. It was considered normal and healthy and good to eat liver once a week. And the liver and the organ meats were hidden in things like sausage, scrapple, liverwurst, pate, and so forth. I call these ways of making offal taste good. And we have a lot of these foods that we'll be serving at the conference today. So these are all sacred foods. Very important to have these foods in the diet. Now, the darling of the modern dietitian is the skinless chicken breast. Lots of protein, almost no vitamin A. Okay? If you eat the skin, you will get a little vitamin A. And if you eat the dark meat, you get more vitamin A, and dark meat with the skin. I know growing up, my favorite piece of the chicken was the wing. I could chew those bones and eat the whole wing because it was such a high skin to meat ratio, you know. But look at the livers. So when you eat a chicken, make sure you eat that liver, because all that vitamin A in the liver will help you digest the muscle meat of the bird. We used to cook in lard. Lard is a wonderful source of vitamin D. This is a kind of joke thing that's going around the internet. They're happy because they eat lard, but it's absolutely true. The vitamin D in lard helps the body make neurochemicals that protect against depression. Now, there's a third fat-soluble vitamin we need to talk about, and we call this the price factor. Dr. Price called it Activator X. He didn't quite know what it was. They kept finding it in these foods with the type of primitive tests that he was using. He found that it was a potent catalyst for vitamin mineral absorption. It's very important for the growth of children, very high levels in the sacred foods. And the basis seems to be green growing plants. There's something in these green growing plants which the animals transform and store in certain fatty tissues. Now, for many years, we did not know what this price factor was. And then we stumbled on some research which led us down a path. And finally, we came to realize that the activator X is vitamin K2. This is the plant, the animal form of vitamin K1. So when the animals are eating green plants with K1, they turn it into the K2 form. And we know that vitamin K2 is critical for growth, especially facial development. A sign of K2 deficiency is the underdevelopment of the middle third of the face. So we really knew we were on the right path here. Vitamin K2 is needed for the deposition of phosphorus and calcium in the bones and teeth. And if you have a lot of K2 in your saliva, you will not get cavities. It has nothing to do with eating sticky foods, or although eating sugar may displace vitamin K2, but it's the K2 that protects against cavities. When you have K2 in your saliva, you're constantly putting phosphorus and calcium into the teeth. Dutch researchers have found that heart disease, that K2 prevents calcification and inflammation of the arteries. So what we associate with heart disease. K2 is involved in the synthesis of the myelin sheaths and supports learning capacity, and is vital for normal reproduction. And once again, these vitamins work in a synergy. You need all three of them. This is why we need to get them from foods, because they're all three contained in generally the same foods. Vitamins A and D tell the cells to make certain proteins, and vitamin K activates these proteins after the signaling. Food sources of vitamin K. The number one source is actually a plant food. It is a fermented soy product called natto. And natto is definitely an acquired taste. The restaurants in Japan that serve natto have special rooms where they go to eat the natto, because otherwise they stink out everybody else in the restaurant. So I would prefer to get my vitamin K from the next best source, which is goose liver pate. Cheese is an excellent source of vitamin K. Not only is it in the butterfat of the milk, but more is formed during the fermentation process. Egg yolks, butter, chicken liver, fatty meats, all good sources, and sauerkraut is a source of vitamin K. And other probable sources, we haven't tested these yet, the fat of birds, the yellow goop inside crustaceans, bone marrow, organ meats, fish eggs, and we have found it in the fermented cod liver oil. This little girl, this is one of Dr. Price's favorite photographs. She's holding fish eggs. He found many cultures that valued fish eggs when these Peruvians lived at 12,000 feet, but they carried the fish eggs up from the seacoast, the dried fish eggs. When he asked them why they ate the fish eggs, they said, so we could have healthy babies. And so all of the components in the fish eggs, activator X, which is vitamin K, vitamins A and D, zinc, iodine, special fats, all essential to healthy reproduction. My gift to my daughter when she was pregnant was that I had an order of caviar sent to her once a month. That was mom's gift. So we are big promoters of a what we call high vitamin cod liver oil and high vitamin butter oil. Dr. Price used these two in combination to get dramatic results. He brought people back from the brink of death with alternating drops of high vitamin cod liver oil and high vitamin butter oil on the tongue. Now, the high vitamin butter oil was something that he developed. He took butter from cows eating rapidly growing green grass. He centrifuged it at low speed, low temperature, extracted an oil where these vitamins were concentrated. He also had access to a high vitamin cod liver oil, and he found that the cod liver oil didn't work as well unless he added the butter oil to it. These were not available to us when we started the Weston A. Price Foundation, but fortunately David Wetzel of Green Pasture Products is now making a high vitamin cod liver oil, and he figured out how to make the butter oil. The most commercial brands of cod liver oil are not high vitamin, and they actually have synthetic vitamins added back in. How much cod liver oil should we take? It depends on the dose. We recommend for most people a maintenance dose of 10,000 units of A and 1,000 of D. which you get from 1 teaspoon of high vitamin cod liver oil or 2 teaspoons of regular cod liver oil. And please go to our website to see the recommended brands that we recommend. You double this for pregnancy and lactation. Illness, recovery from surgery, you can take a very high amount for a short period of time. And babies and children, it's half the recommended dose. So it's about a half a teaspoon of high vitamin cod liver oil. How do you take this awful stuff? Not on a spoon. You want to make someone hate cod liver oil, give it to them on a spoon. The easiest way is to mix it with a little water or fresh juice or a little milk. Just a little bit, stir around, down the hatch, bypass the taste buds. That's the way I do it. When my children were little, we had special shot glasses for cowboy whiskey. And when my boys came down to the kitchen for breakfast, they had to come up to the bar and have their cowboy whiskey. And it was fresh orange juice combined with their teaspoon of cod liver oil, and they had to drink it back like cowboys, all in one gulp. And you explain to them that this will make them healthy, that they'll be good athletes, whatever it is appeals to them, that they'll be good athletes, won't get sick. When they grow older, you can explain other benefits. And books on infant feeding before the 1950s recommended 2 teaspoons of cod liver oil for babies 3 months and older. This was in all the old baby books. That disappeared with Dr. Spock, who recommended vitamin D drops and vaccinations instead of cod liver oil. Now, cod liver oil is very unsaturated. It's a liquid oil. It works best with saturated fat. You want to take it in a diet that where you have some butter, grass-fed cows, and in many circumstances, you'll want to take it with the high vitamin butter oil. High vitamin butter oil is expensive, but we are really seeing dramatic results with this combination. The brain is an organ of the body. It needs good nutrition, just like every other organ of the body. The key nutrients for the brain are vitamins A, D, and K. Choline, which is needed to make connections in the brain. If a baby is lacking in choline, at certain windows of development, those connections will not be made, and you can't go back later and make those connections. This is why we are so insistent that pregnant women eat liver several times a week, at least 2 egg yolks a day, and nursing women the same, and then the weaning foods for baby are egg yolks and liver. DHA is very important for neurological development, and zinc, which we get from red meat and fish. We hear a lot about nutrient-dense foods. USDA is always talking about nutrient-dense foods. Eat your vitamins and eat your fruits and vegetables. And I just have news for them. I'm not against fruits and vegetables. I think they're great foods, but they're not nutrient-dense foods. When you compare them to red meat and liver, we have apple, carrots, red meat, and liver. Look at the difference. Look at phosphorus. Phosphorus is the fuel in our cells. It's the fuel in the little motors inside our cells. Look how much higher red meat and liver are. Iron. Zinc is the one where red meat is higher than liver. If you are someone who needs a lot of zinc, you need to eat red meat every day. Some people don't need a lot of zinc, but some people do. Copper, vitamin B2. There's no vitamin A in plant foods. A little bit in red meat. Look at the liver. There's more vitamin C in liver than there is in apples and carrots. B6 and B12, a huge difference even between the red meats. See how much higher. You can eat liver once a month and get the same amount of B6 and B12 as you can from eating red meat every meal. So those on a budget, you really want to favor these really nutrient-dense organ meats. Now, the way to make fruits and vegetables nutrient-dense is to put a good fat on them. So if you put butter on your vegetables or cook your, vegetables in lard or something, then they'll be nutrient-dense foods. Cream on your fruit. Calcium, at least 1,500 milligrams per day in the primitive diet. U.S. government recommendations, not quite that much, but that's still a lot. How do we get this calcium? Well, you can drink 5 cups of whole milk or eat 7 to 8 ounces of cheese, and you'll get a good amount of calcium and not too many calories. If you want to get your calcium from carrots, you need to eat 40 carrots. And that's 1,680 calories. If you get your calcium from ice cream, a lot of people do get their calcium from ice cream. They crave ice cream, right? You know? And that's how they get their animal fats and their calcium. But look how many calories. Or from chocolate cupcakes. Now, almonds are a great source of calcium. You only need 4.5 cups of almonds to get all that calcium, over 4,000 calories. If you want to get your calcium from bread, you have to eat 78 slices of whole wheat bread, and that's 4,300 calories. So this is what we mean by nutrient dense. You get a lot of nutrition at a low level of calories. This is why dairy foods are so important in the Western diet. We don't eat fish heads or fermented fish. Dairy foods are providing us with not only calcium, but lots of other nutrients at very low levels of calories. Okay, I think we'll do maybe one or two more. Can we go another 5 or 10 minutes? Okay. Next underlying characteristic has to do with cooking. Should we cook our food? We have the raw foodists out there telling us that human beings shouldn't cook their food. But actually, cooking is one of the characteristics of human beings. All traditional cultures cooked. The Eskimos cooked at least some of their foods. Even in the tropics, where they didn't have to build a fire for warmth, they cooked a lot of their food. They built a fire every day to cook their food. So a lot of these foods were cooked, especially the plant foods. Plant foods are much more nutritious when cooked. Grains have to be cooked. But as for the animal foods, they always had some of their animal foods raw. The animal foods were eaten both raw and cooked. Examples of raw animal foods include raw milk, butter, and cream, raw cheeses, raw and marinated fish, raw shellfish like raw oysters, and traditional ethnic raw meat dishes such as steak tartare, carpaccio, and kibbeh. Kibbeh is raw lamb from the Middle East. So it's interesting that every European culture has at least one raw meat dish that's eaten occasionally. And it's really fun to sit on a sidewalk in Paris and eat a whole plate of raw beef. We don't know all of the reasons for the raw animal foods, but one of them has to do with B6. B6 is very fragile. It's easily destroyed by heat. And B6 deficiency is linked to all of these diseases. And so this is a very important reason to include some raw animal foods in the diet. It could be raw milk, or it could be raw meat, or raw fish, oysters. My husband is not a dairy food person. He doesn't like milk. He eats 2 or 3 dozen raw oysters every week. I can't stand raw oysters. It makes me sick. But I drink the raw milk. So there's many ways of getting your raw animal foods. And one of the key conditions associated with B6 deficiency is alcoholism. If this is a problem in your family, you want to make sure you're getting lots of raw animal foods. Raw cheese is a perfect food if it's truly pasture-fed from grass-fed animals and truly raw. It will have everything you need in it, A, D, and K, all the minerals, all the vitamins, including vitamin C. So, and it's a storage food. It travels. It's very, very dense. You don't have to eat a lot of it. Okay, we'll stop here. And it's noon, time for a good lunch. And we're coming back at 1:30. So you have plenty of time to have lunch and visit the exhibits. If you have some burning questions and you want to come forward, I'm happy to answer them. Thank you. Thank you.